Okay, I will now call the meeting to order. This is the July 9, 2014 meeting of the Conservation Commission. We have a quorum present. Hello, everyone. Let's get to 26 Harrison Street. And this is the first time we are discussing this matter, so let me get up the script.
I don't think the applicant is here.
I don't think he is here either.
Is the resident for 26 Harrison Street here? No. I don't know if they were, do you remember, I don't think, did he say, I know the
Didn't he say he had to work?
The gentleman said he couldn't.
Yeah, he said he had to work.
He wasn't gonna be there, so.
Yeah, so we can proceed, I guess.
Yep.
Any neighbors from Harrison for this? Guess not.
No, I guess not. Okay. We did do a site visit. Terry, Jamie, and myself. It seems that this particular project was previously permitted under the Conservation Commission. Let's see what date that was.
'02.
2002.
Mm-hmm.
And it was not recorded. Just trying to find my notes. Here it is, here it is, here it is. Okay, so with this matter, it was approved, a previous order of conditions, bless you. Previous order of conditions was issued, however, that has expired. And at this point, there is, it's my understanding that there's really no vehicle to go forward on this project without them refiling a notice of intent. Is my understanding from Chuck. So at this point, I think that's what we're going to advise that they do, and it would simply be a change of date on the plans and a change of.
Well, their plan is somewhat different.
Oh, the plan is brand new.
It's a larger, somewhat larger shed.
Yep, they just need to resubmit a notice of intent.
Which they did.
No, they haven't officially.
Well, it has a number.
That was the previous number.
Oh, you're right. I think you're right.
Well, let me just double check. 27371?
That's the 2002.
Yep, that's the 2002 number, so. So at this point, we will advise them to reissue. And
Well, there is a possibility of an RDA.
Go ahead and explain. Expound on that.
It's all an existing lawn. They're more than 35 feet away, just barely. But it is a new structure.
But it's conversion of existing lawn.
Conversion of existing lawn.
Conversion of existing lawn. Now, there are wetlands flags. There's BVW flags on the plan.
BVW as marked is the top of the channelized stream, channelized in as fieldstone retaining wall on both sides of the stream.
Is that it, or is this, oh, this is top of bank, the open granite culvert. So it's actually, difference between 51 and 35, 16 feet off the top of the granite culvert, according to the plan?
I don't know, this is one that could go either way. But I think I'd lean toward a notice of intent, just because it's a brand new structure.
Now, it should be noted that during our site visits, we did not see wetland indicator plants.
Right.
Essentially, it's backyard lawn, right up to, I would say, within 5 or 10 feet of the open granite culvert to the west.
Was this a lot where they, where Fran found hydric soils in the lawn?
This is next door.
Next door.
And this lawn, if you, there were no soil borings taken. If you did, there'd be a chance that in the top foot, you'd see some hydric soils. But under our new regulations and the state regulations, if it's no wetland plants and there's no hydraulic connection, direct hydraulic connection, then even if they are hydric soils, it's not classified a wetland.
Right, okay.
So we didn't, now there is, this is a little bit different than the one next door in that there's, just guessing, but there's an extra half a foot plus or minus of loam that's been there for decades that makes it a little bit higher than that one next door.
Yeah.
So if there are hydric soils, it would be just barely.
Yeah, okay.
So, If it was up to me, I'd go with the notice of intent, but if somebody, if the majority thought an RDA was appropriate, I could go with that too.
I think a notice of intent is appropriate.
I mean, partly because the plan does show them going right up to the 35-foot.
Too close.
Yeah,
buffer.
They're close.
Okay.
Okay.
And there'll probably be some grading changes, I would imagine.
I think it's just a small little shed. I don't think
well,
it's just...
Well, the garage is outside, the shed is inside.
That's interesting. I thought it was a slab, so let me just double check that.
So you don't think it'll need...
I'm not sure it's going to be...
Or any grading around the proposed garage? Yeah, in any case,
yeah,
I would...
Yeah, well, we could see that in the...
I would agree with the chair that notice of intent is appropriate in this situation.
Yeah, I wouldn't argue with that.
Any objections to that, Mr. Sullivan?
Well, I would say that, is that the previous line? It's previous wetland line?
Yeah.
Yes. But I mean, I have to say it's a bit confounding to me because it's lawn and then...
Right up to that.
And then it's lawn and then top of bank.
But that's
with
what
maybe
I'm saying.
A couple trees. I mean, it doesn't look like... A typical wetland vegetated habitat.
Well, if that line has moved away from the house, and they're near 50 feet away with the wetland, then I'd entertain an RDA.
As I said, I wouldn't disagree with that. But if that's the case, we probably have to ask them to redo that line.
It would
line.
Have to be flagged, yeah.
But it's been 12 years since it was flagged. That's a lot of time. There hasn't been a lot of change in this neighborhood, but I think it would be prudent to look at that again.
I mean, if they want to proceed with this, they can, but they may be able to go RDA, at least I think.
Right.
You know, if they're 50 feet away, you know.
Right.
Lines move both ways, and, you know, almost all the time they seem like they penalize people, but in this case it might help them out.
Yeah.
Does anybody else?
No. No. Should we just?
I think it's on the edge. I think it's a toss up. I think we're covered under a notice of intent, and since an order of conditions is already prepared.
I mean, they've already spent most of the money with this plan for a notice of intent.
It would be their option. I mean, obviously they have to.
And it's a flat fee now for a notice of intent for a single family.
Okay.
Was it 300, 350? I forgot, something like that.
Yeah, it would simply be a procedural
pass
through. So.
Yep.
Okay, so Chuck, can you tell them our notice of intent?
Chuck's not here. Our administrator's on vacation.
Okay.
If you can just put that in the minutes, then highlight it to Chuck.
Yeah.
Okay. In that case. Moving right along. Other papers I have. Excuse me while I shuffle through here. uh,
Kim, do you know if George Stemboris is gonna be here?
I asked engineering today and they believe he is. He's not in, but he should be here.
I also got a call from Ryan Percival saying.
Oh, Ryan's gonna be here?
That George was anticipated. Okay.
Before we go on, can make a statement about 364 Lowell?
Yes, absolutely. For all those who, did we say it on here?
It is
written on our agenda, but for all those who are here for 364 Lowell Street, that project, the Jamison Properties project, that notice of intent has been officially withdrawn. So we are not going to discuss that matter tonight because the permit's withdrawn. So,
do we give them their filing fee back when they withdraw?
I don't know. I don't think so. You know, that fee is for the administrator costs processing their application.
Well, the fee goes into the general fund.
It goes into
really
the general fund, which everything dips into.
I did call Chris Nolte and left him a message, but I didn't go further down the phone tree to try and notify more residents, so I apologize for that. But so basically, we're back to square one on this project, or square zero?
We don't know what's going to happen next. It's up to the applicant to decide
right.
whether to pursue a different permitting approach, or to withdraw it altogether, or redesign, or I don't know what they're going to do.
Did he call Chuck and talk to him in person, or was it just a letter?
Oh, it was in writing.
I think it was. I think it was just
a
letter.
It was a letter. Yeah.
I didn't.
It was sent July 2nd.
No, I think it was just a letter. So those people who are here for 364 Lowell Street, you're welcome to stay and enjoy the rest of the hearing.
I have a question back there, Anita.
Yes.
Yeah.
That. Okay. It's my opinion that it was the general consensus of most members of the commission that it probably was a vernal pool. And with the data that was collected, one of the commissioners, Mr. Finch, actually submitted an application to National Heritage. They're the group that do certify vernal pools for the state officially. Now, it doesn't have to be officially certified for us to consider it a protected resource. We just need, according to our regulations, we just need evidence that it fulfills the requirements for certification to be called, to be protected under our town bylaws.
So an application that goes to them, and then do they come back and tell the commission yes?
Well, they list it on the state register as a certified vernal pool, give it a number.
Special
they
identification
don't give it a name,
number.
But they give it a number.
And directions.
Is it the whole thing or just an area?
Well, the interesting thing is it's they put it on the maps as a point, but that's a little bit misleading because the definition of it is the mean high water line of the
extreme,
flood.
Extreme high water.
So somebody has to really delve into the, you know, yearly water levels.
Right.
Out there, and then map that, so survey it, identify it, map it, and if that ever happens, you know, I don't think National Heritage has those mapped areas at all. I think what we have right now is a rough point on a map that is somewhere near the vernal pool area.
I sent them a copy of the plan. With the vernal pool, or where we heard I heard the wood frogs chorusing,
yeah.
And the plan included the delineation for that entire wetland.
From Alden Wall Street all the way down to the railroad track.
Yes, so Natural Heritage has that information. You know, I sent some aerial photos and the plot plan and everything that I could find, and I do still have a recording, although they don't require a recording to be submitted. So Right, no, I, you know, it certainly, and I think that, I mean, it's just speculation, but I think the owner of the property seemed to be getting the message that it was a vernal pool and they were gonna have to seek other avenues if they wanted to develop the property. And what that will be, I don't know, it could be a 40B application, say.
Would that go through?
That would be through the zoning board of appeals, and so you wanna keep track of their agenda schedule, nothing showed up before
they
them yet.
They would still need a permit under the wetland, State Wetland Protection Act, though.
To get the road in and all that.
Right, yeah.
We're in the same mess all over again.
Well, it's a little bit different, 'cause they don't need to get the, they don't have to comply with the town bylaw for wetlands, just the State Wetland Protection Act. And they are a little, those two are a little bit different.
The zoning board of appeals can basically follow the lead of Conservation Commission in terms of, they can take our advice, at the risk of having the project denied at the state level, at the Housing Authority Appeals Court, as an appeals, you know, if they get denied by Zoning Board of Appeals, they can appeal to the state, and it gets pretty complicated. But in the past, the Zoning Board of Appeals has worked with us, trying to uphold our regulations in terms of drainage and protection of wetlands, but they would need public input, just as you've given us here. They would also need public input and testimony to help them make a decision.
Two of the big differences in this case between the State Wetland Protection Act and the town bylaws are, number one, under the state program, it has to be an actual certified vernal pool, whereas in the town bylaws, it just has to be eligible for certification. That's one difference. The second big difference is the State Wetland Protection Act gives this local conservation commission jurisdiction over the 100-foot buffer area. And it's up to the discretion of this commission as to what we allow and what we do not within that 100-foot buffer zone. In contrast, the town bylaws state explicitly that there can be nothing built within 35 feet of the wetland border, and there can be no disturbance within 25 feet. Under the state plan, under the State Wetland Protection Act, there is not a 35 or 25 foot setback. It's purely on a case-by-case basis at the discretion of the commission. I guess the third difference is that under the State Wetland Protection Act, if we deny it or approve it, the appeal goes to DEP. Under the town bylaws, if we approve it or deny it, the appeal goes to the courts. That's the third big difference.
There's also information from Leo Kenny, who was working with high school students to delineate or certify the vernal pool at the end of Plymouth Road. And he feels that since the wetlands are really all connected in that area, that and the, you know, the wood frogs have been heard in various different places in that area, that the entire wetland is a vernal pool. You know, it may change from year to year, but and also when I submitted my data to the state, I gave them a new GPS coordinate for the original vernal pool that was delineated because the one on the plan that the state had was inaccurate. But based on, you know, descriptions of where the vernal pool was in terms of text, I was able to relocate that accurately. And also, I did find a dead wood frog in that location, in an adjacent, that ditch right along the railroad. So that whole area has been used by wood frogs.
Any other questions?
Try to do something again.
Well, Chuck has a copy in the office here of all the documents I sent to the state. As far as I know, we haven't heard back from the state. They're so busy that they're probably still processing all the data from the spring season, from the pool certifications. So we'd have to, that part of the puzzle I don't really have an answer for, but we have all the information here on what I submitted.
Any other questions about 364 Lowell Street?
Thank you. I think all the abutters tonight to the board has done a great job on our behalf. I know for a fact I've seen a few of you down in the water looking for these things, and you've done very good.
Thank you for your input too at the meetings. That's been very helpful as well. So.
Yeah, I'd just like to make clear that we're not opposed or trying to impede development. We're trying to protect the resources that we have in Reading. That's our goal.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
No further discussion on that. Let us move to the next item of business.
James Road.
Yep, James Road. This is, we're going to reopen this notice of intent. At this point, the public hearing for notice of intent 270-0629, 37 James Road, map 6, lot 38. Booker Isle, please tell me how to pronounce that because I've pronunciation problems. Okay.
Pukerel.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is now reopened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 5.7. The hearing will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant will present the proposal. The commission will receive reports from technical advisors, town departments, or its administrator. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. The public will then be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. Please give your name and address before your comments and or questions are presented. An attendance sheet is at the entrance door, and I encourage all of you to sign in. At this time, would the members of the Conservation Commission please introduce themselves, starting with Kim.
Will Finch.
Jamie Maughan.
Anika Scanlon, Chair.
Brian Sullivan, Vice Chair.
Okay, and I think we have Mr. O'Connell. Welcome back.
Thank you.
We received a additional memorandum and additional plans from you. We did not do a site visit. That was optional. A lot of us have been there and have mucked around in the wetlands down there. And our last site visit ended around 8. I've been bitten by bugs.
So for the record, Madam Chairperson, is Richard J. O'Connell, President R.J. O'Connell Associates, 81 Hale Ave, Birmingham, Massachusetts. Please excuse the attire. I'm on vacation, but I go to
You too?
Yeah.
Somebody's on vacation too.
I called from Mark this morning, and unfortunately, he's in the hospital again.
I'm sorry.
He's here, and Jed's mother.
He'll be comes out.
So basically, we had at the last meeting we came up with some things that we did this and this on the plan and got it back in.
Mm-hmm.
We could get the order written. And we did that. I don't have any of that with me because it's all at the office and I never stopped there. But I think you all have it.
We do.
We do.
On behalf of Jen and Mark, we just want to thank you for going through the process and getting this done. Get this done tonight. It's just another milestone or hurdle that they can go on to moving on. So
yep.
We're here for questions. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. So I'll get over to the commission members.
I have a question. As I read this, you are totally assigned the 35-foot lot. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And you have a little riprap slope stabilization.
Uh, shut portion of the area, then probably about 20 feet or so.
Right, and it looks like the elevation of
thanks
is of that riprap area is maybe 3 or 4 feet, something like that, to change in elevation.
Yes.
That's all I have.
Okay, go ahead.
My only comment is I've looked at the plans. I think you satisfied our concerns. I'm fine with 3-to-1, 2-to-1 with the stabilization mat and the wildflower mix. I think that's great. And the proposed plantings look appropriate. They look appropriate for the area. I think the proposed plantings are definitely appropriate for this area. So I think all the conditions have been satisfied as far as I'm concerned.
One more question, just out of curiosity, I don't see, although it's a little bit, but a specification on the size of the riprap, do you have?
I think we submitted a specification on that, and I believe it was 12 minus, because it's not really riprap, it's a pyramid, but I believe it was 12 minus.
Okay.
That sounds appropriate.
Yeah, that's I was afraid it was just a crushed stone.
No, it was 12 minus, and I believe it was 18 inch lifts on the back side.
Okay, thank you.
Just for your information, the letter that was presented by your counsel regarding the ADA regulations and how they intersect, bisect, or how they relate to the wetlands regs in the town bylaws. We put that out to our town council for comment because none of us are lawyers. And we have not received any response back at this point. The town council is recently hired by the town.
Who did we select? Do you know, George?
I
could tell you.
Forget the name offhand. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So I guess I'm wondering, we don't have any response from town council in preparation for this meeting tonight. So I guess I'm wondering. I'm wondering if
everything goes well tonight, Madam Chairperson, I think it would be you.
Okay. That was one thing I wanted to bring up.
Although at some point in time we'd like to hear. For our future reference.
Yeah.
Because I mean there are so many overlapping jurisdictions. It's, I think for all of our benefit it would be nice to know what does that really mean.
Yeah. A total green layman's stab at trying to figure that out. And so, you do the Google ADA regulations, town bylaws, and see what pops up. And the ADA website came up and said there was actually a section of the regs that says this is how the regs relate to town rules and bylaws. And I thought, is it that simple that like the answer just it talked about public spaces and accommodations that had to be made so that there wouldn't be impairments in public spaces.
Right.
This isn't that case. So, again, it kind of threw me back into, I'm not sure exactly.
The whole public-private thing is a whole different avenue.
Right. So.
Madam Chairman, since Chuck isn't here and we can't draft an order of conditions, I think we would be remiss to close the public hearing because then that would start the clock.
Right.
However, I do move that we issue an order of conditions to be drafted to incorporate these revised plans and planning plan for 7 to 7 James Street.
37 James. So let me just get this clear. You're making a motion that an order of conditions using the existing information provided be drafted.
Yes, and it would keep the hearing open.
Well, let's have a second, and we'll discuss it.
So this is not a motion to approve an issue?
No, it's just a motion to discuss issuing.
No, it's a motion to approve the order, to issue an order of conditions.
Right, so.
But not close the meeting.
But not close the meeting.
Yeah, I'll second.
Okay, so, if we draft this order of conditions, that, and not close it, that means we're still leaving some space, some time, open to answer further questions.
Right.
If anything, if any additional questions.
Well, you know, our issue is our administrator.
Right, if we close the hearing, we have to issue the order of conditions within, I think, 21 days.
Right.
Which isn't gonna happen.
Right, right.
So by leaving it open, then we can close the hearing in 2 weeks and hopefully issue the order of conditions at the same time.
Yeah, in terms of these plans, let me just.
That could help us, obviously we would like to, as Jamie pointed out earlier for the other proposal, we would obviously like to see those order of conditions, so we would not want to close the hearing because the appeal goes to the wrong place, bottom line. We don't want to be going to court.
Right.
So it would be nice if we could keep it open.
Okay.
Get a copy of the order, discuss them with you, and
mm-hmm.
have it ready for the next hearing.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I can't be sure that we'll get the order of conditions drafted prior to the next meeting, but I would hope so.
Yeah.
But certainly, we will go over it line by line and discuss any questions.
Mr. O'Connell, at this point, do you think there's any... Can you imagine any additional engineering schematics or additional engineering schematics that you think might be pertinent to the
not
final order of conditions?
So requested by the commission. I think we've got everything.
Okay. Okay. With the general and erosion control notes, the limits of disturbance.
Yeah, and I reviewed the planting plan, the different species you propose, and I'm in agreement that those are good plants to put up.
Yeah.
It's like at the top of the slope, around the edge of the lawn. And I think you specified 12 substantial new plantings. So,
yeah.
That's what I'd be looking for.
So hopefully a wetland will redeem itself from his initial concerns.
Did we issue an enforcement order?
We did because of the cutting of the trees within the buffer zone.
This would close that enforcement order.
I'm just going to the 12, it says in your memo, your goal would be to replant 12 substantial new plantings. I just want to, can you sort of reiterate on the plan some sense of what and where?
On the landscaping plan, which is the third plan, the LS.
Yep, I got it.
We have bubbled up.
Yep, two areas.
Two areas
yep.
where we would propose to plant them, along the top of the slope itself, and then in that back area where it starts to, it's actually where we met that night when you were taking the sidewalk. It was right in that area where it comes down rather sharply from the neighbor. It wasn't really clear cut. There's some brush in there, but it could use to have something in there to help stabilize it, really, if that was the area we were thinking.
Okay. So I guess I'm not certain what a substantial new planting is. It's not herbaceous. Anything that's, are you thinking? Or are you thinking? I'll show you in your memo if you here it goes. You don't have the
superfluous.
to compensate for what trees were cut down. Go ahead.
Okay. Yes. So the 12 substantial new plantings are off that list.
Here.
That
or sheet
plant.
Three.
Yes. So any one of those we would consider to be the substantial.
Okay.
And
okay, and these are all shrubs and up.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank
you.
Okay, I just wanted to understand that a little clearer.
Can be more specific in the order of conditions.
Yes.
Like.
But this list is not herbaceous, this is shrubs and trees.
Right.
So this is, these are, would be substantial.
These are substantial.
Yeah.
Yes, they are.
Right, and I would just direct the administrator when you're writing the order of conditions to make the language a little more clear.
Yep.
There will be 12 substantial new plantings and in the text and the plan, you know, potential landscape plantings, well, it should be, that's a little vague in a way.
Sure.
What we've asked for some help on is the timing, because all of this is, goes out to donations.
Yep, 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 we understand.
And we can certainly, we'll refer to, we can refer to the table and the.
You know, and the proof of the pudding is when we do a site visit, you know, at the end. And, you know, a lot of it's site specific, so we just, you know, planters know where to put things and how to space them.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what we rely on.
Yep, and I have to say, you know, native plantings in that whole landscape plan area are going to do a great service to the adjacent vegetated forest. It's going to reintroduce native species, which supports the native plants, which supports the native animals and insects and birds, and it keeps the creatures that best thrive in this area healthier and more hardy. So I see it as those plantings as a clear compensation for what was cut, because it's going to improve that vegetated area. And if it thrives there, you know, maybe it'll spread to the invasive area closer to the wetlands. So I don't have any additional questions. Any more questions from board members? Any questions from the public? No? About this matter? Okay. No? Okay. In that case, you moved that we issue, that we draft an order of conditions and continue the hearing. We issue an order of conditions, and so, and that was seconded. All those in favor? Okay. And I move we continue the hearing to the next meeting in July, which is, let me check my calendar, July 23rd. Mr. Finch, you're not going to be here, according to my notes.
That's correct.
On the 23rd, so feel free to give, if you get that draft by email, give Chuck your input on that.
Yeah, I'll be in touch by email. And if we can get that draft at any time prior to that, too, it would help.
Yeah, I understand. I'll make a note. So there's a motion to continue. Is there a second? All those in favor? Okay. So we're kicking it down the road a little bit to get to a final document to sign off and get that all taken care of. Thank you. Okay. Just take care of this. Okay. One 10 Main Street, minor plan change for order of condition 270-0615. Let's see. Is there a representative from Hayes Engineering here tonight?
He said he would not be.
He would not be here. Mr. Ogren, I believe. Would you like to come forward? I believe you are the residents at 1102 Main Street.
Yeah, my name is Marwan Kuki, 1102 Main Street. I just have one question on the area where the driveway is moving to the left. That tar area that could be dug, what are you putting in on that side of the driveway?
The engineer from Haynes told us that would be vegetated, and it would be up to you and to him whether you wanted lawn, whether you wanted grass or shrubs or wherever you want. Our only requirement is that it is vegetated.
Well, I mean, the, nobody discussed it with me yet, but grass will be the best, because my concern, the driveway is 10 feet wide, as you know, which is not too wide. And now we are moving it, so the stone wall going to be at the edge of it, where the existing driveway, there is like 5 feet of grass.
Right.
To about 2 or 3 at the end of the driveway. Mm-hmm. If we lose all that, and it's going to be only the driveway.
Right.
It happened to us, I mean, we've been there 50 years. You get the snow and the ice, the car wiggle a little bit, and now I'm between hitting the stone wall, which happened very close. We came to the existing one, never mind this. And on the right, we have a little buffer zone with this, you know, the wetland. It's green, soft landing, we can move to it. But if they put some kind of trees or,
That's
you
up
know,
to,
I mean,
to you and him.
I don't have, so it's between
but
us
for,
and them.
Right, but for my in my opinion, grass is fine.
Because he mentioned, like, we can put the grass if
yeah.
somebody wants to mow it. Well, it's not my property. You know, it's like, why should I mow it unless, you know,
right.
it falls down.
You can have your daughter mow it since she's going to
she
be
can.
Running.
This is my daughter. She's 4 feet.
I think she's going to want to get paid for that.
So forget, we hire people to do it, but it costs me money.
Right.
But anyway, so it's between us and the construction. Okay.
And it doesn't have to be grass. It can be naturally vegetated. You said trees.
No, that's
well,
what I don't want.
They don't want trees. Cause
see, I don't want something
well, like,
solid, because if you put a tree around the edge,
right.
10 years from now, it's going to be
yeah.
over my driveway
right.
hitting
mm-hmm.
the other tree that you want to keep that may build it.
Well,
so,
I do want to say, I mean, there's a portion of that swell that is the 25-foot buffer zone. You know, and I can see why you would want the area closest to the road to be like grass so
mm-hmm.
that you have good visibility and you have a place for
exactly.
snow. But, you know,
there are trees now. I mean, what's there, but they are not right on the edge and they are not very healthy because of the
right.
water.
Right.
But to plant something new, and it will grow fast, it's rich land, and before you know it, it's going to overshadow the driveway. But now I don't have the luxury of this grass on the other side. I have a stone wall.
Right.
So if I go left, I'm hitting the wall.
Right.
So,
I mean, I need something like low shrub,
yeah.
but it's fine, as long as it's not something massive,
you
or
know.
Something that will go on the 10 feet driveway. Because
okay.
then I have to keep cutting it.
You know, I think.
I mean, I can't lose any portion of the 10 feet.
Yeah.
And you get a truck,
yeah.
utility, if they come, that's wider than, I mean, they're going to hit any
right.
obstacle
right.
in their way.
The swale, so here's the plan. Maybe I'll just put it up. So here's the plan, and here's your house, and here's the driveway, and the previous driveway was just straight in like that.
Yeah.
Now the additional land, if you'll notice, this line right here that says 25-foot buffer zone
mm-hmm.
from here to here, this is an area where typically we call for plants that support the wetland to be established and shrubs, but maybe between the 25 and 35,
yeah,
maybe from the 25
from that
out.
Line here. That's the existing driveway that
okay.
we are losing.
So, but let me just say, from this line out
mm-hmm.
is the 35-foot zone.
Mm-hmm.
If that were all grass, is that sufficient for
mm-hmm.
your purposes?
That's
and then from that line towards the wetland, it can be native shrubs.
It doesn't concern me anything.
It's more
here.
It's
my
more
main,
this
my
little
main
corner.
Concern is the edge of the driveway here. Because now this is the 10 feet. And this, I mean, it's the knob of a little
precision.
I know, it's hard to tell.
I mean, the stone wall is going to be on the edge of the car driveway.
Depends, well, it won't, because these arrows here mean that they're gonna angle the driveway. They're gonna pitch the driveway so that the water that runs on here, the rainwater, is gonna flow in this direction.
That's fine. Like I said, my main concern is this line here.
So it's gonna have a slope.
Because, you know, whatever they plan in that new space up to here, I wanted like you said, grass, you know, something low that we won't hit or anything, because we are too close.
Okay.
You know, the 10 feet from here.
Does anybody know if this property line, I can't remember, I think you may have answered it out in the field when we met with you. Is this property line going to have a chain link fence?
I think so.
Not.
Because they put a fence now to, for like.
For protection of the site, the access to control.
No, because we are having a heck of a time when we go back from my parking space.
Right.
From here.
Yeah.
The fence that they put, you cannot back a space. I mean, that's again, when I talk to you about going this way.
Yeah.
Because the fence is in the way. And now when we come, the fence is right there, and the width of the car really.
Is exactly,
you know,
exact match.
So it doesn't give us any, I mean, if a truck comes, I don't see how they can make it now with the fence. So there will be no fencing, just vegetation, whatever the width and.
Do you see, Mr. Mann, do you see any of that on the plan, like how that's gonna be finished, or?
Well, we don't know whether or not there's gonna be a fence or not.
Yeah, I don't think we have our.
But we're taking it pavement in proximity to the wetland, well within the 25-foot setback.
Right.
And we're moving it beyond, well, you can't say we're moving it beyond the 25-foot because it crosses it, but it's moving substantially away from the wetland, and so we're getting vegetation close to the wetland where
right
now
here.
We have pavement.
Here, you mean?
No,
or
no.
Up
there.
Here, we're getting vegetation where before we have pavement.
Yeah, my concern is the vegetation here.
Yeah.
You know, if it's similar to what we have there.
Grass.
It's a grass, that's fine.
Grass.
3 years, maybe 2-3 feet farther on it, fine too. I mean, that's
right.
What we have now.
As
but
long
anything
as
on the edge.
Nothing, no large trees right
exactly.
On the edge. Well, I think that's.
And no fence for sure, because the fence will.
Drive.
I mean, now I have a stone wall and a fence and 10 feet.
Right, right.
Any truck will hit the fence.
Right. It is tight there.
Yeah.
It is tight there, but
I mean, 10 feet
is
minimal, and that's what it is. But we don't want to add something, you know, like a fence. I mean, now, if an emergency happens, you go a foot or two on that grassy area, it's not going to fit anything. But to put a fence or a stone wall, that's different. Because in the past, with the greenhouse,
right next to this
they are
like
parked when they come, and every time they come in the
but you won't have trucks because the road is.
Yeah, but I have utility, not like a horn.
Yeah.
When they come,
right.
They always go on the grassy
right.
Area because they won't
too
fit.
Wide.
They are
wide
out of 10 feet. But that's what I wasn't sure if you are recommending. Certain things to be planted
well,
or leaving it to them like vegetation. I mean,
it's still approved.
I would imagine that was in the existing order of conditions for
what
this.
What was?
The planting plan for this area.
Well, there wasn't going to be any planting because they weren't going to do anything. They're just going to leave the driveway where it was.
Yeah.
Right, but
the detail specifies grass. It's a grass swale.
Okay.
And where does it, where around the front side does it become vegetated non-grass?
The swale looks like it goes down to the, you know, beyond the 108 there. If you look at the 108 contour,
yeah.
Where the connection to existing is,
yeah,
that's still
this,
the swale.
And that's,
yeah.
That's water there, yeah. I mean, you are joining the existing wet area here with the new area.
Right.
That we are going to create
right.
By moving the driveway. So it's going to be all part of it. But if we put the grass in this new area, rather than a tree, that will solve my problem.
And it should be grass, and it should be incorporated into the maintenance plan, whether or not they're gonna mow that grass swale like this.
I mean, I don't want to put it in writing, I'm going to be responsible of mowing.
No, it's their swale.
Exactly, but I don't know what their plan, I mean, it's a big project, they will have landscaping.
Right.
Company, but are they going to come near this conservation and wetland, or they will do the landscaping in the back?
Well, they're moving the property line, correct?
Hmm?
Yes.
They are moving the property line, correct?
Yes.
And I assume they're in negotiation with you to get that property line moved, correct?
It's moved and it's given to me. And we signed a separate agreement.
I would think part of that negotiation would be to reach agreement on what was gonna be planted there, but from our standpoint, or from my standpoint, as long as it's vegetated and not paved, we're good.
No, that's, I have no problem.
So you don't have any concerns about native buffer zone planting?
No, I mean, we're losing paved driveway and putting in grass, it's a net benefit.
And then it is now.
Yeah, I mean, I'm losing half of the driveway on the top, giving it to the wetland.
Right.
And the back, you are having the whole thing, wetland also, beyond that easement in the back.
Well, I guess, you know, unless other people on the commission can clarify this, it's still, I am still unsure as to where exactly the grass extends and the other plantings from the approved artist project come in. I mean, you know, this is part of the plan, but I would like to see, I'd like to see some response from Hayes about this. About the planting strategy for this portion.
Brian's, I didn't see it, but Brian said it's big grass.
Yeah, and Hayes mentioned during the visit.
But like I said before, I mean, there's a tree here, a tree here. Aren't there other plantings that are proposed in this area that we approved? As part of the notice of intent? And where exactly do those end and the grass begins? I mean, you wanna say the 108-foot line?
Well, we're not changing that. We're
but
not
I
changing
wanna know,
that
I wanna know
planting
what
plan. It should be in our files.
I think this is part of the process during construction and getting the certificate of compliance and doing the site visits. There's gonna be a lot of work on this project, and Chuck is gonna be involved. And I think we can convey to him the desire to keep a grass area next to the driveway so the trees aren't growing up too close to
We haven't seen the plan yet for removing that culvert. So that's the big thing.
Oh, really? The one that's
it's under here somewhere.
Oh, okay, yeah. Oh, I thought it was further back there.
Oh, you're right, it is. It's farther back. It's back. Yeah, it's
so
right there. There it is, right there. There's there's the
culvert. Basically, we can go to Baffio. I mean, we, you know, working with the administrator, but just keep the channels open with Chuck Cerami as the construction.
It's only a question. I thought you are recommending certain thing, but if you don't care whether grass, bush.
I don't believe we have a preference.
Okay, and there is no problem. And just when we remove the tar, what are we putting in place of it?
Right, yeah.
And if we can put the grass or something low.
He says grass, and I'm comfortable with that. If you want some low bushes, that's fine. That's up to you.
The same with me.
But I just want to speak up and say that, you know, especially in this area right here, the area between right here, between Wetland Flag IWI 103, right where that 25-foot and the 35-foot buffer zone line are, and that over
OHP. I'm looking for Wetland Flag. What number?
Here, I'll show you. Here. In this area here, it is not clear to me. You know, there's a dot here that says grass swale, a dot here that says grass swale. But at what point are, you know, is this grass right up to the wetlands,
well,
and that's
it? That's certainly
and
something we can ask artists, but that has nothing to do with this plan change.
That's beyond the driveway, I'm.
Yeah, but I, he needs to get this taken care of so they can get their property taken care of.
Okay.
And I would say everything outside of the grass swale is what it was before.
Exactly.
Right.
This would not change it.
Okay, okay.
So I move we approve this minor plan change and described in the plan submitted to the commission dated June 24th, 2014. That's the June 9th, but that's his.
No,
yeah.
Can I just ask, where is the erosion control for this project? What is that dotted line? It goes. Okay. Okay. All right, just wanted to see that. Okay, so there's a motion to approve a minor plan change. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay, all those in favor? Okay, thank you. Thank you for coming in.
One more question. Can we start construction now within?
We have to draft.
Yeah, I mean, when you send the letter of.
Letter.
Of your vote, and is it finished or?
It is finished. We have to follow up with some paperwork and our administrators on vacation.
I mean, within a few weeks.
Yeah, a few weeks, yeah.
So beyond that, we are ready to start.
Yes.
No more meeting or?
No.
No.
I don't know, if you need a building permit for that wall or not, but Hayes will know the answer.
There is paper, I think the construction, whoever going to do the construction, he has to do the necessary things. Also, he has to submit to the Mass Highway Department.
No, we can't comment on the need for building permit or anything for the hearing, just like they can't comment on anything regarding the wetlands.
Well, we could get some input, but he hasn't looked at the plans.
But Hayes will know.
The wall's over 4 feet, they're gonna need it.
It's 3 feet, it's fine.
It's 3 feet, so they don't need a building permit for it.
All right, thank you very much.
All right, thank you. Any other?
Thank you. Enjoy your new home.
Our home.
Wish my kids would buy my house, so I'll get a little bit.
Okay, Mr. Zamboris, we're now gonna take up the matter of 33 Ash Street, request for determination 14-11. Would you like to?
I will.
Delve into it?
If you don't mind, I'll sit.
Go right ahead.
I got a problem with that.
I'm sorry.
I don't know how long I can stand.
It's okay.
Basically, what we're proposing to do here is actually, let me explain something first. When you see here the DPW garage is here. Here, all this is wetland and it continues all the way over to 128. Right along the property line between Reading and Wakefield, quite a few years ago there was a sewer line installed. And then they, back in 2004, I believe it is, and maybe off a couple of years in the date.
That's right, that was on completion.
A water main was installed.
Yep.
And it services the Walker Brook Drive area and it's one of our main trunk lines. Right adjacent to the railroad property, the easement where the easement is, we have the sewer main and we have the water main, and it acts as our access easement to gain access to the utilities. Just before the railroad tracks, there's a drainage swale to act as an open channel. I couldn't even tell you how wide it is. I think it's at least 6 feet wide, maybe more. That's supposed to serve as an equalizer for the wetlands to balance the water levels on each side.
Each side of that sewer easement?
Yes, I mean, basically our sewer and water easement just for the most part bisected the major wetlands there.
Where is Ash Street on that map?
Ash Street.
Okay.
Is right here.
Okay.
And once it gets into Wakefield and turns into Parker Road. And right about here, Parker Road, just before 128. At 147 Parker, there's residential property that's been experienced some problems, and they've been in contact with Wakefield for probably a few years. They have water problems in the basement, and they have indicated to Wakefield that their house is sinking and their property sinking, and it appears to them that ever since the water main went in, that a lot of the trees in the wetlands have been dying from increased water levels. We've contacted East Middlesex Mosquito Control to go look at this area to see what's going on, but they're not going to be able to get out there to do anything, if anything, until late summer.
Mosquitoes are healthy out there.
Yeah, it's active mosquito season, so they're for the most part this time of year, that's all they're dealing with is problems with mosquitoes.
You're afraid you guys might get bit.
Well, actually, it's funny you said that, because when I talked to them, they said they're going to wait for a cool day to go investigate.
We walked it.
I walked down the easement was a few months ago, and I probably got to about here.
Did you have boots on?
Without boots.
Wet patches.
Just in regular shoes. I walked out there without shoes, and it wasn't until that point that this was probably at least 2.5 to 3 months ago. And it was at that point there, it didn't appear that I was seeing a difference in water levels on each side. I believe it was 1.5 months ago. I took a walk out there. I couldn't remember if Chuck made it or not. I took a walk out. The Wakefield Town Engineer, Wakefield Conservation Administrator, Elaine Vreeland, and I believe Chuck was there too. And it was clearly evident that the water levels on this side of the easement are higher than the water levels on the opposite side of the easement. And I'm sure as you walked out there, you could see that also. So what we're proposing to do now is, and if you walked out, you only saw one stake, not two, because I couldn't get out to where I wanted to put the second stake in.
Yeah,
as it is
we
now,
saw the one stake.
We didn't. You
as it
we
is.
Didn't know if the second one was there.
No, I don't think we're going to need two stakes. I mean, two swales. I think right now we'll try it with one, and all we want to do really is just to dig a trench across that our access easement, fill it with crushed stone, just to. Rather than put a second swale in, and that way there, hopefully it will alleviate some of the high water levels we have on the easterly side of the easement until Middlesex Mosquito can really go out there and find out what's wrong. The only way to get to that swale at the end, you can only get there after a long, hot, dry summer or in winter when the ground's frozen. Unless you want to walk down the railroad tracks, there's no other way to get to it. There could be fallen trees that are blocking it. It could be beaver dams. Who knows what it is? There could be other things internally in the wetland that's going on that may be stopping the water from flowing.
When Nick and I were there Monday night, there was at least a foot difference in elevation.
I was going to say it might even been more than that, and I know on my cross section that the crude cross section I drafted, I figured the swale would only be 6 to 12 inches deep. In that location, there's no question on the downstream side, it's going to be at least 18 inches deep. That swale was I did not recall seeing the easement access easement that much higher than what the wetlands are, but it was in that location.
Do you envision the invert of that swale being level or sloping to the west?
We're just going to make it level. We're just going to dig a trench. We'll start from the downhill side, what I call the downhill side, the westerly side where it's dry. Go about halfway across before we run into any water, fill it all with crushed stone, and then continue excavating and filling until we start draining, and it's possible that we may have to, you know, to make sure we don't disturb anything, we may have to wait a few days to finish it too, I don't know, we'll see what happens.
Are you bringing the crushed ground up to existing grade?
Right up to the surface, right to the grade, right to grade.
Okay.
So.
Like I say, that's just for a temporary measure.
It'll be a French drain is what it'll be.
Pretty much, yeah, we just, we know, we're not gonna go below the, we just wanna hit existing ground level to existing ground level outside the easements, just so it acts as an equalizer, that's all.
It's a little detail point, but what size crushed stone, what?
One inch. One inch. One inch crushed stone. And the.
I got a question,
Can you hold on just?
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
And we'll, yeah, we'll, everything will be excavated right into a truck and hauled out, and so that we won't be dumping anything on the, ground.
Okay, is there anything else you wanna add before I open?
No, if you can open, that's fine.
Go ahead, sir.
I got a question.
Could you please just state your name and address?
Yeah, my name's Mike Tyne, I live at 337 Ash Street in Redding.
Okay.
The whole problem with this is they haven't dredged that brook in 25 years. That's the whole problem with everybody's water problem, she has water problem down there, he has water problem. I can, I got a 200 signatures of people having water problems. But it's the, I got paperwork here, and it says right in here that you guys are supposed to maintain, excavate, construct, maintain, repair, relocate, ditch, which means dredging. It's signed by the engineer, and I mean, you guys, I can make copies of it and give it to you. You guys already have this, because I gave it to you guys like 15 years ago. It should be in my file. If you look on 337 Ash Street, you'll see it. But they should have drained it. They used to drain it when I was a kid living there. It used to be like 6 feet deep. Nobody had water problems. Nobody down towards Wakefield, nobody down Ash Street, nobody down Brook Street. Everybody was fine. They dredged it all out, channeled it all out. They haven't dredged it since. And
just for the sake of enumerating, could you just are you able
yeah.
to sort of roughly show on this where the channel is? Because I don't
right there. That's Ash Street right there.
Right.
That's Brook Street right there.
Right.
They got that. There's a brook that runs right across my uncle's property. Well, is that that ain't the brook? That's the water line, right?
That's a drainage easement.
Yeah, the brook
These
is right here.
Lines.
Yeah.
The brook is right there. That goes there. But they haven't dredged it. I'm telling you, I've walked down there with my sons, and I pulled trees out like this. Beavers taking down trees, and I was speaking with the engineer department about it too, because it's gonna wash the road away. That bridge that was there used to be 6 or 8 feet deep. It is now a foot thick. You can only see a foot through it.
That's
when
the
water rains. Yeah, when the water rains. It's over that drain, so it's just a matter of time that street's gonna wash. So this is a problem that has been ongoing. My great grandfather allowed him to put the easement in through the property. You guys, not you guys, but the town made the deal with them to maintain and dredge this brook for its natural born life. They have bigged on that deal. So there's something needs to be done with you guys. We own a brand new clam digger. I mean, my taxes just went up. I know everybody else's taxes just went up. And I'm telling you, I bought a $3,000 lake sucker for 400 gallons a minute. Every time it rains, my uncle calls me because he gets flooded. I lost my furnace. I can't tell you how many times I got flooded. I got like 6 pumps in my house. I mean, it's just, you know, this is a problem that's been ongoing, and something needs to be done.
I wish I could say your experience is unique. In town.
Well, everybody here can vouch for it, you know.
No, I'm not saying.
Madam Chairman.
I understand what you're saying. I just want to hear.
Madam Chairman, if I may, while they're all related because they're all hydraulically connected to the wetland, the drainage easement and culvert that he's talking about is not related to what I'm trying to do.
No, it has no relations, but it runs into it, and it overflows. That brook raises 3 feet to 4 feet. That thing used to be 6 to 8 feet deep. Now it's about a foot deep, so when it raises 3 to 6 feet, where do you think that water's going? It's going across Brook Street. It's going down into Brook Street, and it's coming around. I see it. I mean, everybody here lives there. They see it. They know it. And you may think it has nothing to do with it, but that brook, that easement that you guys put, runs parallel with the brook. And the water table rises 3 to 6 feet, 3 to 5 feet. Where's it going? It's going this way. where's the water going? It's going to these people's houses, just like it's going to my house. It needs to be done. This is something that needs to be done. I talked to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, and you guys have vigged on a deal. I mean, the town of Reading has vigged on this deal. So, I mean, whether they want to have a lawsuit and we have to take this to court to get something done, I mean, we can avoid this all, and you guys make a decision and get a hold of who you need to get a hold of to dredge this brook.
I'm not here to argue with you.
No, I understand.
I'm here to
this
listen.
Is why I came tonight, because this has been an ongoing thing, you know?
Yep, and you're obviously upset about it.
Yeah.
And I hear you, and I understand.
I lost my furnace.
I've heard residents and in other parts of the town during a Mother's Day storm a number of years ago that their entire basement got 8 feet of water in it. There are some people in town that run their sump pumps 8, 9, 10 months out of the year in other parts of town.
This is storm water, though. It's not like it's a natural brook. This is storm drains. This is storm
water
that
natural.
Needs to... Yes, but
it
was man-made in 1943.
Discharged.
It wasn't there in 1938. It wasn't there in 1936. 1943, they put it in. You want to see the paperwork? I have it here.
I'd be happy to get a copy of that.
Yeah, I will give you a copy.
You know, I wasn't here when you first submitted that.
Yeah.
If you'd like to...
This is just my family's been here for 100 years, and my family, my great grandfather, he's the one who allowed it to go, and they used to dredge it. And up until I was 9 years old, then they stopped dredging it, and then after that, it's been trees have been falling. It's been one thing after another, you know.
Yeah. Mr. Mon?
Just for you and for everybody in the audience, one of our primary charges on the Conservation Commission is to preserve wetlands. One of the reasons we do that is because the wetlands store the flood water.
Yeah.
If we let people encroach on those wetlands and build in the wetlands, there's no place for that water to go except your basement.
Oh, I understand.
So when you hear us be somewhat hard-nosed about preventing people from building in the wetlands and paving right up to the wetlands, that's the reason. So I hope you understand that and will support us in our efforts to prevent the flooding throughout the town.
That's fine. I support you guys, but something needs to be done. And you guys are the ones, because I went down to the town yard, and they said that you guys have put the brakes on running that machine. It's only got 100 hours. We got a clam digger. We own it, and it's sitting there. It has 100 hours on it. So, they used to do it by hand. They used to have guys go out there by hand before they bought that machine. The guys would spend, you can ask any of these town guys, they'll tell you. I can remember it when I was a kid. I mean, this needs to be done. I mean, I shouldn't have to go out there with my son with a chainsaw and try to cut a log that's blocking the water and it's diverting it to my uncle's basement. My uncle's 90-something years old, you know? He calls me every time it rains. He's like, you got the lake sucker going? And I says, Uncle, I'll put it there. And when do I pump it? Right out into the street, you know? So 400 gallons a minute is going out to the street. You know, and just to get it over the bridge. So, I mean, Home Depot came in, they diverted the whole channel system and did what they wanted. We're living here paying the taxes for everything, for every this, for all of this, and nothing's getting done. Something needs to be said and something needs to be done.
Let me just ask Mr. Zamboris, who is our town engineer.
Yep.
I know that there are certain areas in town where you know drainage is a serious issue and street flooding as a result of stormwater runoff is a serious issue. Is this on your radar? It is now.
It's not an area that floods the road right now.
Okay.
If you give it another year or two, maybe 2 years, 3 years, it's going to blow that road open. And when it does, I'm going to say, I told you so.
Your address was 337.
337. You look at that bridge on Brook Street, you can't only see about this
one. I'll be back to work next week. Are you home during the day?
Yeah. Well, I'm in the afternoon. It's like 3:30, 4 o'clock.
Okay. I'll stop by on a Tuesday evening.
All right.
We didn't identify this area in the river study as a problem area. So.
No, it's not.
It's a big problem.
No, the model stopped at the garage.
And just for your information, you know, I think, yes, I pay fees everyone who lives in town pays fees towards the stormwater management, maintenance and management of the stormwater system. And work is constantly... Thank you, the Stormwater Enterprise Fund. And Mr. Zernboris can talk to the schedule and, you know, and the projects going on, ongoing, to improve stormwater management across the town.
Yeah, because it's ruining my property. I mean, it's ruining everybody else's properties.
Yeah, and
I mean,
I'm
watching big, huge oak trees just fall, you know, uproot because it's just, they're not used to water. I had U.S. Army Corps of Engineers down there, and they said the same thing. The only reason why these trees are falling, they walked through the whole property with me in the back and everything.
Because they're inundated.
Was because this has been neglected for so long.
Yeah.
And he goes, yo, I mean, my land perked out in 94, and now it's, you know what I mean? It's, trees are falling everywhere. So I got 4.5 acres behind my house, you know?
Yeah. So we're going to move on with this.
Yeah, no, that's fine. I just
your
wanted
voice
that,
is heard.
Yeah.
If anybody else wants to speak about that matter, yes, sir? Go ahead and give your name.
Lance Stride at 352 Ash.
352 Ash.
Yeah,
okay.
So I'm kind of right in the middle of the wetlands. I'm just wondering what's going to happen when they divert the water right behind my house.
Well, which one is your house?
Mine is where the two dotted lines kind of intersect on.
Do you mind walking up and just
right
showing us?
Yes, that piece.
This is 352 right here.
Correct.
Well, right now, the water that's on this side, besides ground seepage, it normally is supposed to go through a channel over here to go into this wetland, which in turn goes to the into the brook alongside the DPW garage, down alongside the old TAS building, and across Walker's Brook Drive,
and around
Home Depot and Jordan's, and out towards Wakefield. Where it's only a small, narrow trench, it's not going to be in a rush of water. It's going to be something that's going to be able to allow to release over time.
Yeah.
So it'll just go into the wetland, go into the brook, and just keep on going. It'll be like a prolonged rainstorm right now for the most part in that area.
Right.
Okay, so if I was to say right now, I don't have a water issue as far as water in my basement.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say you go ahead with this plan, and all of a sudden I do have a problem now.
You shouldn't.
But I do. What's the course of action? Are you going to close it back up, or is it just
you shouldn't. I mean, there's this, any water, if you've never had water in your basement,
yep,
you've never had it.
As far as I've owned a house, and you know, it's a...
How long have you owned the house?
2 years now.
2 years, that's not a long time. That's not a long time.
Well, FEMA
that's
said,
not a long time.
Okay,
the reason why I say that is because they're, you know, down around the DPW garage, which is just off the map over here, which is the industrial property, which does have a paved area and a loading dock. I've seen the water to the top of the loading dock.
Oh, yeah.
And if it's up to the top of the loading dock, that means this wetland is completely inundated with water. And when that wetland is inundated with water, I know it hasn't happened in the past 2 years. That's why I asked. I'm sure your previous homeowner probably had water in the basement.
That 14 days of rain, man, that
he
was bad.
He could have. I mean, I don't have a sump up in the basement. It's hardwood floor, so I'm assuming.
Yeah. But I mean, as long, you know, it's short of a large storm like the Mother's Day storm, which was in May of 2005, 2006, whatever it was, six. You know, storms like that, that was about, for us, it was about a 75-year storm event. Storms like that, you may get something. Every day, normal rainage, rainstorms, it shouldn't cause anything in your basement. If you're not getting it now, if you haven't had anything in 2 years, what we're doing there is just releasing some trapped water and getting to where it's supposed to go anyways. It's just that it can't get there right now.
Okay.
Now, like I say, I know that DPW was into, 2 winters ago, cleaned out that swale during the winter. But there's something blocking the water of its normal path right now. So, I mean, it normally goes that way. We're just making it go there.
Does DPW clean on any train tracks, or is that MBTA problem?
That's MBTA.
That's
open. That's
is
open.
Is it really?
Yeah. Well, this whole wetland area, you know, the area you're talking about, This whole wetland is actually flat. It had three discharge areas. One, the brook you're talking about by your property.
Yep.
One over to the DPW garage, and two was over through Wakefield. It doesn't go over through. I mean, there is a culvert underneath 128 to get into a wetland other area in a swale over on 128, but it doesn't go across the tracks like it's supposed to anymore, because it used to go across the tracks, across North Street, and end up in the lake. It doesn't go that way anymore. So all this wetland, other than what's going into the groundwater on the Wakefield side of 128, this wetland for the most part is being drained down through the DPW garage.
It seems to me, Mr. Zimboris, that your two sort of backfilled trenches are going to be a very, very small leader valve.
That's
for,
all.
For the wetlands
and this
that
is,
are to the
And this, like I say, is just temporary until mosquito control can get in there and get out to that brook in the back and see what else may be causing some of the problems. Because it's, when I put the stake in, the water levels were drastically more than what they were a month and a half ago.
Yeah.
Of course, it was right after a rainstorm too, so, but who knows. It just has a little temporary fix.
Any other questions from the public at this point? One question I have, and it's kind of more procedural than anything else, is this is filed as a request for
RDA.
Mm-hmm. With its proximity to the wetlands and its how close it is to the wetlands and the fact that it is digging right up to the wetland itself, would it be more appropriate if it were filed as an NOI?
If you prefer, that's fine.
Does anybody else have
anybody want to put on that?
Let me float this idea and see what kind of reaction I get. When would you be doing this? The next couple weeks?
I'd have to check with DPW crews, but most likely, yeah.
What if we approve under an RDA one of the trenches? And
I can't do another one right now. I mean, I'm only doing that one where that one stake is.
And then
can't
the
get
near
it
one.
The close, yeah.
If that takes care of the problem until the mosquito gets in there, we're all done. But if it doesn't and something else needs to be done, then we come back with a notice of intent. Now, the mosquito doesn't have to file a notice.
No, but they will submit to you a detailed plan and explain what they're going to do. I mean, years ago, they used to just do their work. Now, they try to be friendly with conservation commissions, and they at least explain what they're doing.
So if we limit it to one, I'm good with an RDA, but if you want to do an NOI, I'm good with that, too. But I think we should just approve one tonight, see how that works.
Yeah, I guess a track record, see how it goes, if there's any impacts.
Mm-hmm.
So that would give us more information if the mosquito people come in.
It's pretty small structure compared to the area of
yes.
these two wetlands. I mean, I can't see that it would do damage to.
It's a few hours
habitat.
Of work and a few hours of work in the morning. That's
yeah.
it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so I move we issue a negative determination on RDA 14-11, 366 Ash Street, DPW.
And the project being. Just the southernmost
mm-hmm.
trench.
I'll second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Thank you.
I have a copy right now.
Oh, you do?
I do.
Oh, we need to change it to be just one.
Yeah.
Thank you for hearing.
Okay.
Thank you for coming. And
did you say Tuesday?
Paperwork, or
do we want to line through this and say one?
Yes.
So just line through that.
Yes.
Then?
Yes. Why don't we do that?
Mm-hmm. Very good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Yes.
Which one?
The one closest to Ash Street.
Yep.
Yeah, that's I'm going to get a little bit of
Okay, this one, I modified it.
Oh, good.
And I signature. Okay. Two copies of this.
One was mine.
I'll steal this.
Probably, no, I think I got mine over here. No, this is mine.
This next one is a notice of intent.
Yes.
So.
So Brian's our administrator.
He's, it's awesome.
She's got the book, she's got the files there and everything.
All right.
All right, thank you.
Yes.
Or do you wanna do,
What do we? What's our agenda?
Walnut first.
Let's do, let's stick with our agenda, Walnut Street. So I'm going to open the public hearing for, we don't have, for notice of intent for 152-156 Walnut Street, map four lots, 101 and 102, Town of Engineering, DPW, Town of Reading, Engineering, DPW. Is now open to being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 5.7. The hearing will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant will present the proposal. The commission will receive reports from its administrator. The commission will address questions and or comments to the applicant. The public will then be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be addressed to the chair. Please give your name and address before your comments and or questions are presented. Please sign in at the attendance sheet at the door. And at this point, with the Conservation Commission members, please reintroduce themselves, starting with Kim.
Kim Saunders, recording secretary.
Will Finch.
Jamie Moore.
Anika Scanlon, chair.
Ryan Sullivan, vice chair.
Mr. Zamoris?
I'll stay in for this one.
Okay.
Good evening. What's before you is a notice of intent to replace an existing drain line, a brand new drain line, unfortunately, and to install the drain line, we'll be actually installing a pipe in the buffer zone. What we're talking about is 152 and 156 Walnut Street. This is Walnut Street down here. Curtis Street is over here, and South Street is up here. North is directly to the left side of the map, it's not straight up. There's an existing drainage easement that runs from Curtis Street to Walnut Street along the property lines and through the property of 17 Curtis, I think it is. No, it's blurry, I can't see it from here. And there's actually an old 18-inch drain line that's still active partially in a new 30-inch drain line that runs through the easement. The existing drain collects runoff from the wetlands right around this location here, runs underneath the house, and terminates at a dry well.
Is that your design, George?
No,
your
no, no.
Looks like something you come up with.
And typically what happens, during small storms, it's somewhat adequate. During larger storms, what happens is the homeowner puts a manhole, puts a pump inside the dry well, and pumps out to the street, it runs down the street, and there's no drainage in this area. There is some drainage along here and down the street further, so in the winter times, obviously, if the conditions are right, it causes problems. To show you how we got there, at least how I think we got there, we did find this old plan, which was prior, which was prior to the whole area being built out.
I saw that.
Post-war. This line right here is the stone wall. It's the property line, which is the angled line coming down, running
And if you can see, there's, it also shows a culvert coming across the roadway here with a little bit of a stream heading in this direction. The house where the pipe drainage line goes underneath is right in this location. So what I surmise is this area here basically collects runoff from properties between South Curtis and right about this area here between Wall and South. And there's, you can see there's evidence of some natural swales. There was one that was coming down along this way, and there's another one coming this way. This one over here is kind of obliterated a little bit. This one here ends up to where the pipe now, the inlet now stands. So I believe what happened is that this place always naturally drained off in this direction and eventually down to the brook going by Sturgis Park through the development, whether it's this house, other houses, whatever, but it trapped the water, the natural flow of water. This plan was in 42?
For the sake of me putting context to that, could you just estimate where 156 Walnut is on there? Because I see Walnut Street.
I can do one better.
There you go.
If I turn this plan this way, see this line here, which is the property line between 152 and 156 Walnut?
Yeah.
That's the stone
wall.
That's
the stone wall.
This right here
okay.
is where the brook is. That's where the easements are now. So 156 is right here. This is 162. This is the existing. This is the house 62 on the Fitzpatrick's.
Yeah.
And their property line is probably right about here.
Wouldn't 162 be that way
no.
of the wall?
No.
Once.
162 would be that way, and 152 would be.
162, 156, 152.
That's not how it's shown on here, though.
No, this is upside down.
Upside down. Like this.
Okay, I gotta go upside down.
Yes.
Okay.
You see the easement right there.
Is that it? Which, what the plan of the drainage improvements where it shows the easement, that is where the brook is right now. That's right. I'll be aware of this show. So, back to the other one.
Clear as day. Or not.
Maybe sitting.
Do you happen to know if the dry well is clean and clear, or?
Last time I looked inside, which was probably 2 years ago, yes.
I believe the residents here, sir, who
I
lives in 152?
That's Pat, that's not the property owner, that owns the dry well.
Okay.
Who owns that dry well? The town or 156?
156.
And 156 owns that 12-inch concrete pipe?
Yes,
line?
Yes.
Okay.
And you're going to...
We're going to abandon it in place.
And he's okay with that?
Yes.
What's he going
to do? What we're doing is we're... I apologize, I have to sit. The existing 12-inch right now ends here, and there's a little bit of a channel here, there's a little bit of a channel heading off this direction. As you get through the wetlands, we picked up what you could somewhat call a channel when we located it. But what we plan on doing is starting at the manhole in the easement, coming out of the 18-inch pipe and invert grade, putting in a new manhole, and then snaking our way through the 20-inch drainage easement we have. We're going to use HDP pipe so we can bend it and try to bend around every tree we see. If you did go on the sidewalk about a little better, about 60%, 70% of the way down, we say an 8-inch tree to be removed. We don't have to remove it. It's already down.
Okay.
Now, I thought that when we had shot that there was a dead tree, and indeed it is. It is now laying on the ground. We should not It should not be necessary to remove any trees. There is one 4-inch tree right about, probably in the location of the, in between the P and 12 of proposed 12-inch pipe, in that vicinity.
We think we can even miss that. Actually, we put a flag on it, if you went out there, if you'd happen to see it, that we said we're gonna try to save it. But it's literally a 4-inch tree. I say unfortunately, we're, this will be disturbing. I have what shows a maximum limit of disturbance, where we say when putting a silt fence with a dash dot line. And in the NOI, I had indicated 410 square feet of disturbance. What that was calculating was from this dash line to the edge of the buffer zone, that complete area. That's why I left it as maximum. I think we can do it in a lot less than that, but we will not disturb more than 410. The wetland flags, I don't know if Chuck mentioned it, that was something that he helped us locate last fall, I believe it was. Our plan is to get in there, install the pipe, clean up, regrade, put it back to the existing conditions, use the existing soil that was there. I did indicate in the narrative that we'd be using wetland seed mix. I forgot how many shrubs are in there. We can either do one of two things. I can either say that we'll use a planting plan that is similar to what we're using at the Belmont and Ivy crossing, or if you'd rather, I could just get Kurt Young to go out there and develop a specialized replanting plan just for this location.
At this point, you were saying, you mentioned that no trees, you don't anticipate
I would say, if anything, there's probably one 4-inch tree that we might have to come down.
Mr. Mona and I did go out there, and it looked like there was pretty thick herbaceous cover.
There is.
And not a lot of shrub. Well, there's probably some shrub growth back there.
There's a little.
But it seemed
I can have
pretty
Kurt,
thick
I can
vegetation
have.
Existing.
Mm-hmm.
To do that work, how much of that shrub and herbaceous cover would be decimated? Do you assume it'll probably all be gone?
I don't. Well, you're going to have a corridor right through. You're going to have at least a 6-foot wide corridor right through where the pipe is. That it's either going to be gone or. It might as well say it's going to be gone anyways. So we can use the small machine, but you're going to get a 6-foot wide path going through there that it's going to get disturbed on. There's no question on that. I mean, I can have Kurt work up a.
It might be good to
plant.
Have a couple of plants in there,
mm-hmm.
Just to set up reestablishment. I don't think it's going to have to be densely packed, and there's enough there that would probably volunteer itself again, especially if you're refilling with existing soil.
And
the seed mix will help with that
right.
too.
And you know, and we'll be the proposal is to do it, during the dry part of the summer, so that it's that we not have standing water in there. We're in the wetlands, we're in the do not disturb zone.
Right.
But I mean, it's our existing. And we have to replace the drain line, and we can't keep the drain line where it is. It's underneath the house, and this is putting a drain in the easement. It's unfortunate that's where the easement is. As far as mitigation, if I don't know if there's something that the commission's aware of downstream from here, or leading down to Sturgis Park, if there's some work or something else within the watershed area that may need something. I will be filing for a bank in
the one that I walked with you.
Yes.
And John.
For bank restoration, we have a little blowout in the bank that we have to take care of. We'll be doing a file.
It's between the playground and
At Sturgis, where the brook takes the bend?
Yeah.
It's just after this part of the bend. I want to stabilize because it washed out the bank a little bit, but probably about 7 or 50 feet from the curve, there's is an area where when we flood out in the wintertime, it just made an underground path and a blowout right to the sidewall of the stream.
Groundwater discharge eroded the side of it.
So we just have to do a little excavation and
slumped the land.
See what was there, whether there's an old pipe, bunch of stones or whatever that the water found its way, and then plug the dike and put it back together.
My concern is that we don't dewater that wetland. And if I look at these plans, it looks like the existing invert that goes to the dry well is 226.5.
I'm matching inverts.
And it looks like you're matching.
I'm matching inverts and matching pipe sizes.
And you're going, you're only dropping about a foot when you go into that 18-inch pipe. Isn't that at 25.17?
Yeah, it's an 007 slope. It's an 007 slope, and basically the last, right at the flared end where it's a little steeper right at the last couple of feet of pipe to get it to match. But we're coming into the 18-inch at the invert grade of the 18-inch, 225.17.
Okay,
So our intent is to, you know, just allow for a more positive means of runoff during high frequency storms, but maintain the levels that are out there so we maintain the wetlands that are there.
What would happen if you made that invert, let's say 227?
Which one?
At the upstream end of the 12 inch pipe, would you cause any flooding?
At the upstream end?
Yeah.
At the inlet?
At the inlet. If that would give you.
I'd be out of the ground.
It would be?
Yes. Yeah.
Because there's a small channel, a couple inches deep, that leads into that existing flared inlet.
We can, well, it just, I shouldn't say that. I mean, we're still, I mean, I have to put a little 5-foot swale. That's what the little 5-foot swale is at the end, because the pipe's out of the ground. Coming up a half a foot.
I just want to make sure that we don't dewater that well.
Well, that's why I'm matching inverts. I mean, to come up a foot, half a foot higher, you're making it a half a foot higher.
Then we give it more wet.
But then, you know, one of the problems we're doing is because, you know, during the high storms where this sits fuller than what it should because of the inadequate pipe, means of discharge of the existing pipe. It is causing water problems in the basements in the area.
You'd have a little more slope on your 12-foot line.
No, I would have a little more slope, but we'd have a 5 inches higher water level.
Right.
You're not concerned with inundation?
Inundation.
You mean into the PVC pipe?
No, my concern is raising it a half a foot. You might kill some of those trees there.
Yeah.
That
which leads to my next question. Did you consider an open channel?
Didn't, we can do it. We're probably.
So is there an existing pipe there?
No.
There's an existing pipe that goes from where we're ending towards Walnut Street and going underneath the house on 156.
Over here.
And this is existing.
Yeah, that
this is new.
Yeah, that's new.
Yeah.
We could.
And at the downhill end, where would it, the open channel?
Right,
it would lead right into that 18-inch snow pipe.
We could only do it for about 40 feet, if that.
I think you'd have more vegetation impact.
But you're gonna, but we're gonna, because the, if you look at the profile, where, you know, we're probably about 9 inches of cover over here, right at this location. We have a foot of cover, but I mean, if we make a channel, then we're gonna have to slope to the sides, and you're gonna just end up, you could disturb, I think we're going to disturb the same amount of vegetation, but then you're going to change what is a vegetated area to the swale area. So I guess it's what preference you'd rather have.
I,
But I mean, we'd only be able to do it for about 30 to 40 feet, then after that, we'd have to go into a pipe.
I'm good with that.
So on that plan, the water's flowing right to left?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So that would mean we'd have an open channel for 30 plus or minus feet, and then it would go into your 12-inch pipe. I'd be good with that.
So that's an inch and a half, roughly, on the plan, from the inlet towards the northwest. And that gains us...
Well, you just have more open flow, animals can live in there, you get some nutrient reduction in there, you get some sediment reduction in there, you get wildlife out of that.
Why don't I look at this?
Yeah.
I forget, I don't, obviously this is in the AutoCAD drawing, so I can't turn the elevations on.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure at this portion of the swaleway, I got the arrow going right now. I know it's higher. I was wondering if we could regrade it. The problem is that this is your low spot right here.
Right.
Where?
Right where the existing inlet is right now.
Yeah.
I mean, everything is coming down to this point.
Right.
If I come up a half a foot, we're leaving standing water there where it doesn't stand.
Well, if we have an open channel, I wouldn't want a half a foot.
Hmm?
I wouldn't want a half a foot. If you have an open channel, stay with the 226 invert, or 226.5 invert of that open channel, and then go right into your PPC, 30 feet or so down.
Well, if that's what the commission would prefer.
That would be not perfect.
You know, let me see what the elevations show and come back with, see how far we can extend it.
Yeah, I'm all in favor of open channels when possible or when it, you know, solves the problem.
If it works, I don't have a problem. I mean, it's because you have part of an open channel in a natural area. Limit some disruption or whatever. I'd say it's... doesn't matter.
Okay, yes, go ahead. Sorry.
Brad Fuller, 169 Walnut Street.
Thank you.
The people, if you go along with the open channel, who's going to maintain keeping that clean? The same ones that didn't do it for 15 years on Ash Street?
Quick answer, yes.
It would probably be the same people that haven't kept the horizontal drain or the vertical drain in that area on Walnut Street open. Where do those two drains show on this plan?
Mm-hmm.
The old drains are not maintained.
The old drains are clean, sir.
Huh.
Well, you could say what you want, but they're clean. There's an 18-inch, there's a 30-inch right here that's running down through here, and then there's an 18 that comes through here and down through there.
I'm talking about the drain in the ground.
The catch basin.
The catch basins are maintained.
I mean, I can only speak for myself. I've seen the clamshell come around by my street already in the spring, at least once a year to clean out the catch basins.
At every basin once a year.
Yeah.
At the minimum.
The catch basins behind 156 Walnut Street?
The catch basin behind 156 Walnut Street we do not own. It's private drain.
But it will become a town.
It will become a town drain.
Yeah.
And it's not, and it's just an inlet. I mean, there's just there's just a grate sitting on top of the pipe.
Well, I guess
yeah, there's no catch basin.
No. There's no sump, nothing.
I guess I'm wondering, maintenance issues, George, if you could address this. What are the maintenance pros, cons for open channel versus inlet pipe?
The problem with any inlet or any drainage channel is before in problematic areas where you're going to have problems, you can go out and look and make sure the debris is cleared from any inlet or whether it's a catch basin or make sure of the swale. The problem is that only guarantees you that the system is going to work on the initial part of the storm. As everyone knows,
when you're gonna have down trees and stuff and everything, that happens during the storm. But you're, and typically that's with a very large storm event or a hurricane or something, those aren't gonna, you can't get to those until after the storm's over. And you know, I want to say all the time, but I'd say there's probably a good 60 to 70% of the time when a branch or a part of a tree that comes down that's blocking a brook or a catch basin or anything, it's something that falls during a storm, not before the storm, not after the storm.
Well, and the bigger the storm, the bigger the debris that's carried with it, because of the fast speed.
So, you know, we try to get the problem areas and make sure the areas are cleaned up and there's not a lot of loose stuff laying around that can get washed into it. But as branches fall and whatnot during a storm, it's going to clog something.
My property at 169 Wallace Street abuts the Sturgis Park, and there's a brook
at the base
that belongs to the town that hasn't been cleaned out in at least 3 or 4 years.
That's pretty good for 3 or 4 years.
You may laugh, but you don't live on Wallace Street.
No, I understand. I understand.
So who's responsible for cleaning that up?
With
all kinds of trees, branches, and everything else. When you have a big storm, the height of that brook goes from 1 foot deep, almost level with the outfield.
And I think,
which is about 4 feet.
And I think, please correct me, Mr. Zamboris and Janie and other members of the commission, but as part of the Sturgis Park redesign, there were to be additional wetlands constructed off that channel to provide for additional floodwater storage. And that's an upcoming project. I don't know the schedule of that. So to address, a rise in that stream, you know, and to slow down the water down, and to also make the peak elevation of that flood lower. There are plans to create additional wetland area to store overflows from that stream.
The wetlands in Sturgis Park now, which was near the street or the playground area, that's going to be moved back.
There's a skating rink right there. There's a number of skating rinks there. There's a skating rink there. There's that whole back area between the pump station and the stream. That's going to become wetlands, correct? Or it's going to be...
Potentially. We haven't filed yet. That will be filed once Recreation has funding to do the project. It's not funded at this point.
There are efforts being discussed to address that at this point. Go ahead.
No, Madam Chairman, if I may, the rise that you're talking about in the brook there is nothing more than the capacity of the culvert going underneath the roadway and the amount of water coming down. There's no blockage on that culvert, and the culvert underneath going underneath the roadway.
It's free and open,
and it, depending on what storm event we have, it's a good watershed. It takes a lot of water. The height of the water is going to rise.
So the pipe is open from under Walnut Street right to Sturgis Park. Is that what you're saying?
No, I'm saying the pipe going underneath
South
Street at the end of Sturgis Park is clean. Because that's what you were just talking about.
And what about the pipe that goes under Walnut Street at 156?
Under Walnut Street, going underneath Walnut Street, the pipe's clean.
Between 148 and 152?
Yes.
So, pipe there. So any other questions or comments?
Yeah, could you reconfigure what you were proposing for that area?
Well, I'm just going on my... Are you talking about Sturgis Park or
no.
this?
No, I'm
Walnut
talking
Street.
Behind the houses
this
on
drain.
Walnut Street. I have concerns about mosquitoes and not the upkeep of that area if you leave it open.
I will either, if you're willing to do
I'll
a
explain.
Big overview and just sort of, if you could start with where flows are going.
That's
now.
Mrs. Fitzpatrick. They live right here.
Okay.
What the commission is talking about right now is right now, I'm, well, the town has proposed is to install a new drain line from the existing drain all the way to
the point of where, in the vicinity of where Mr. Fleming's inlet is.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
So what the commission's talking about now is in this area here where we're actually working in the wetland, rather than install a pipe, can we accomplish the same thing by installing an open channel?
Which is a natural swale. How will that impact the impact, like whenever there's a storm?
It shouldn't.
And also maintenance, because neither of those two storm drains were ever maintained. We've suffered tremendous damage. So that's our concern. And I can give you the whole history of that, having been there 55 years, if you'd like, if that will help.
You mean that storm drain behind 152?
And 156. There were two storm drains when I was a child that were there all those years.
Well, that one that George is putting the green light on is a privately owned and maintained, when it's maintained structure.
Yeah.
What's going to change is it's going to become a town's own
system. Yes, exactly.
And the town will be responsible for maintaining it.
Right. But there
wasn't. It will carry a whole lot more water, a whole lot more water than the existing system.
Without affecting Walnut Street itself, because it sounds like, as Mr. Zamboris has said, if there's wintertime rainwater coming to that existing dry well, then the resident is literally pumping that out. That rainwater goes down his driveway, down Walnut Street, and that's a sheet of ice on Walnut Street.
And if you look at our cement stone wall that's crumbling as a result, that's also a problem. So I'm with you on that.
Yeah, that's
so
going
instead
to take
of
water
that
the
water,
way.
Yes.
Yeah, so instead of that water coming down that driveway and down Walnut Street,
that's what
winter
we were
time,
looking for, right.
That's going to be closed and sealed up so that it doesn't have any connection with water. And then, so the source of the water that was controlling, the source of the water is going to be drained through that pipe to the existing drains to the left.
Which is, we're all in favor of George's idea of the catch basin going this way. I just am taken a little aback by an open stream. It's a new concept to hear about, and I understand your point about the animals. I just don't know how, I don't have enough information to know how that will impact us, because as those two storm drains have not been maintained, there was one there when I was a kid and one here. We've suffered tremendous damage, so I'm a little on edge about how that will impact us, and if it's not maintained or even maintained.
Madam Chair, if I may. Alicia, right now what you have in the backyard through that wetland area is you have somewhat of a natural swale here. There is a swale going off in this direction, off towards behind your house, and then you have a natural swale there that's is only being naturally maintained now when the water's getting to Mr. Fleming's basin.
Yes.
So it's basically the same thing that's there now, which
is
that just rather than this portion of pipe, we're going to see how much we can make that a natural swale to do the same thing what's being done naturally. And it's just less pipe and less disturbance that we end up doing.
Okay. What if that starts to not be a stream anymore and just becomes flat and too much water flattens it out as it did to our property? And washes away any type of banking that would make the water flow towards the pipe.
Well, the worst that could happen, or the best, depending on your point of view, is that the water would pond, but you would still have that inlet in the 12-inch pipe that would be like the drain in your bathtub.
Right.
And once that water got up to that level, it would just flow right in that pipe.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let me just point out a couple of things. Right now, there's only a storm drain here, catch basin, and a catch basin up here. The original brook, you found a great map, by the way, where that was tied in. The original brook went from here right to this property here. Our house was built in the 1800s. This water had no part of our property.
Want to put the other plan up?
No, that's good. No, right now. So I did see maps over the years. My father saved everything. I even started an engineer in our files where this particular catch basin goes to the dry well.
Right.
And
dry well went into the street.
Well, only when he pumped it.
No, underground.
Well,
pipes underground. He was tied in. He had to discharge this stream before he could build the house, this developer in 1959.
That lot was divided, and that house was built
so
in 59.
Are you allowed to just make that a stream when this was an actual drainage system that protected us? Because what's happening now in heavy storms is, and bear in mind, this swell here could be from the two properties, three properties, two I know, not the other that was here, the other two. They pump back. Some pumps go back into this wetlands when they should be going somewhere else, because by law, we can't accept their water. It's wrecking us. So when this swells, because it goes downhill this way now, because of all the development since our house was here,
right,
it's pushing it all from 10 houses. And I know the people that have grown up in Curtis. I know the water issues there. It goes this way, all through here, our basement, our driveway, this whole sill is destroyed going into this catch basin. So my concern is with the change of plans now in the 11th hour of just putting a stream here, I don't know how that is going to work. It may just cause more of a problem because the water always comes from that direction and expands,
yeah,
and then as it drains, it goes that way. So either, I think by law, he's supposed to tie in here, but thank God that they have this easement now from these people. Thank you. This was a great design when George proposed it. So
It will function the same way. That water will it comes into that area, will still leave that area through the new
ideally,
well-made
I hear
pipe.
You, ideally that.
But the house at 152, I mean, if we had a magic, or excuse me, if we had a magic wand and all the money in the world, it would be great just to take that house and reconstruct the original stream and take the water the way it used to.
The
problem
is
the brook.
Way,
the problem
is long,
the brook doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah.
Right,
but right. Well,
we can't
do that. So
yes,
unfortunately, we have to divert the water the other way.
Yes.
But when they built that house, they put in a lot of fill. So it's
yes,
uphill.
Yes.
It's
yes,
uphill. So that
instead
water
of downhill, yes,
that water is not going to come toward Walnut Street. It's going to go in that new pipe the other way.
It's going this way.
Well,
this
now,
is downhill.
Now it will go in that new pipe. It's
well,
the design.
And let me add, if there is a reach of drainage channel, it would be from that inlet area until
30 feet about
for 30 feet, which goes to the see
no,
the two parentheses 2 6-inch near WFA 6.
It's about 2 inches on
the
board.
It's 2 inches.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that if that's designed as an open channel and there's surface water at the land there, kind of expands the catchment area of water.
Okay. Yeah.
That's
yeah,
one benefit to that. You know, instead of it being an isolated point inlet,
right,
if it's a channel and there's surface water, it should capture all along that channel.
Okay. Okay.
As a built low point.
Understood. Okay.
And drive the drainage where
right,
Mr. Zamboris is
and
designed.
What if the new homeowner comes in and says, oh, I don't like this, and I'm going to do that, and what do we do then?
Well,
meaning
he'll have to come
backyard
before this commission.
Okay.
And,
yeah,
and we would be protective of that.
Well, it's good. It's going to have
plus
an easement.
Plus, they can't alter our drainage.
It's going to be an easement over it, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Say that again.
Oh, on the
back.
It's going to have an easement over it, so they can't
yes,
do anything to it anyway.
Okay, great. And also, one quick question. How much is wetlands when it was a brook? It's just been altered, and with the discharge from all the Curtis Street homes onto us, does it matter? Couldn't it just be a catch basin?
What it was yesterday doesn't matter. It only matters what it is today.
But by law, we can't accept their water. So you feel that it will drain that way this?
We have confidence that
okay,
water flows downhill, and George and Boris can take advantage of that now.
Okay, great. Except it doesn't show on the map. But this is all downhill, that's why we're getting...
I do know that Paige Wright is
okay,
downhill.
Okay.
Because we were out there on Monday,
okay,
and
great,
I saw the natural contour of the
right,
land,
where there's a big slope here, and see
yeah,
before it would go in the brook.
Yeah.
So this will be lower than us, so
I
it
mean,
will catch the water?
Will it be lower than your basement elevation?
No,
no.
Lower than where it is now, because it's at the lowest point now.
It's going to be equal to the same.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
The trick... here that we're discussing is, there's a wetland there now, and under state law, we have to protect it and maintain it.
Okay.
And make sure that it doesn't get de-watered.
Okay.
And cease to function as a wetland.
Yeah.
So we can't approve any plan that makes that all of a sudden a dry area.
Right, it's, yeah.
Okay, so we can do, we can approve, something that it, that makes the drainage better, that makes the water quality better.
Okay.
That improves the habitat,
And prevents flooding.
Prevents flooding.
Okay, that's what our concern is. Mom, what do you think? Are you okay, Ma, do you think this, you okay with that then?
I don't know, if they're saying it will control that, yeah, because when my cellar floods, I get seriously ill. I've had fungus in my lungs from it, so I'm very concerned, you know, about what's gonna happen with that whole thing. That's why I raised that question for you to explain it to us.
Yeah.
Because,
Well, I think, I mean, I have to say from my standpoint, that's a significantly bigger effort than this particular dry well.
Great.
Okay.
Well, no, I mean,
because this is a permanent in-place drain.
Yeah.
That doesn't need a sump pump from the resident to activate.
That dry
and it doesn't
well,
even
right.
have to get to that sump pump
yeah.
moment.
Yeah.
It's going to be a self-maintaining.
Yeah.
So you're saying that water is going to go backwards.
Yeah.
That should
in
change.
The other direction.
Okay.
That
because that dry well was tied in
to
the drainage system. It wasn't just a dry well, according to the old map.
There's no drainage system there, so I don't know where it was tied into.
Well, what
the
map,
the old map,
whatever it was tied into. Once it's decommissioned, it is no longer tied into that. Because I believe you backfill it with concrete, or I mean,
we'll plug the end, and we'll ask, you know, if, you know, that. That manhole may serve as part of his foundation on the drain too, so we'll have to talk to the homeowner about
okay.
that.
So
I mean,
okay.
we're only going to plug the inlet.
So in terms of it receiving water from that upland area, it's going to be completely sealed from that.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Well,
okay.
Do we know the integrity? We have no idea of the integrity of that existing concrete pipe, do we?
I was told it was a tar paper pipe.
It was what?
Tar paper pipe? I don't know. George would know better than me, but.
Know.
There were some old topics.
Don't know, we didn't TV it.
But you're saying there was an outlet from that wet well that went toward Wallace?
I've seen maps, and we always believed that's what it was, so we don't know what happened.
It's not working now, because he has to pump the water.
There's no drainage on the street there, so I don't
know. Working, right.
If he doesn't turn on his sump pump, we're killed.
Right, well, see, that will eliminate that problem. That's the whole goal.
All right, well, thank you for all your time. I think that if you feel that, we'll definitely prevent us from being flooded, then
that's the goal.
Great.
According
okay.
to the elevations that he's proposed,
okay.
it should work.
Great. Okay.
Okay.
If
you want to, you know, some of the storms that we are getting in Reading, however, are historic and more frequent than they used to be. That's what the prediction is going forward in the world, is that storms are going to become more frequent and more intense.
Mm-hmm.
We can't change the rainstorms we get, but we can work with what we've got.
Thank you.
I mean, to state again, if for some reason the wetland laws disappeared and everybody built in those wetlands and paved all that area and the runoff went right there, that new pipe wouldn't be big enough. So
I still question if it's big enough. There's been a tremendous amount of growth since that original pipe was put in. It's been almost 60 years. That's a very good point. Yes.
But our one of our objectives is to make sure that anything that's built, there's no more runoff than what's there now.
Perfect.
And we have an
yes.
opportunity to
yes.
increase it. I mean, for example, the one you heard earlier, the old Eric Greenhouse, the
yeah.
artist development off Main Street,
yeah.
they have reduced the amount of runoff from that location by about 30% with their new development.
Great.
And
yeah.
it's required under the new regulation.
Yeah. Because we've never had any rain runoff. The brook was in function for 1,000 years and we were dry, or you know what I mean? So there's been a lot of development, and so this is why they're defunct now, and so now we have to look at it. And George has been good with all that, so we appreciate your time.
Yeah. Thanks for coming out and giving your input about the local flooding
yep.
issues. Any more questions or comments from the public? No? Mr. Zimbler, any more questions or comments from the commission?
I move we continue the hearing. And George will come back with his analysis of the channel
and a planting plan.
And planting plan. Okay, there's motion. I will second. All those in favor? Okay, it's continued to the 23rd?
Thank you.
23rd, July 23rd. Is that acceptable?
That's fine, yeah.
Thank you.
Great,
thank you very much.
Thank you for coming out on your.
Thank you.
We do have an opening on the commission.
You say that?
Yeah,
I've made more trips to Reading since I've been on vacation than if I was working.
I'm starting to think you need to be, we had problems with traffic signals. Okay, thanks.
I noticed.
I was
on Main Street near Dandelions, right?
4 trips I made.
Okay.
No, that's Dandelions. It's
down
the state,
here.
Just downtown.
Down
oh.
here. No, the state did that up there, and I asked questions about that at work.
Well.
I'll give an example. How many times I was out? How many times did the fire department go through Main Street and use Opticom? Every time they did it. Main and Washington Street went on flash.
I love it on flash. Can you leave it on flash?
Chief doesn't like it on flash.
I really hate that light.
Yeah, there was a lightning strike that fried one of the boards in the controller, and it happened to be the controller that deals with the Opticom. So every time the fire department would come through with the Opticom, the computer would sense a fault. The conflict monitor would put the signals on flash.
We should have hit that on our site visits on Monday. We just avoided the tornado warning.
We're going to get one of those strobes in my car.
There was a tornado warning on Monday as well as a severe thunderstorm warning.
Yeah, there was.
Yep. Okay.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, George. Okay.
Enjoy the rest of your vacation.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Do you live in Salem?
Lovely.
Keep coming back.
She's coming back, so just...
Okay. Our secretary, our recording secretary, has stepped out for a moment. You too. Alright.
Margaret got bit by a snapping turtle.
Where?
Margaret?
You know Margaret.
Yeah.
My daughter.
Yeah, I know
where?
Margaret. Yeah.
Where was she?
She was getting the snapping turtle out of her fish trap, where she's working in Ohio. And it's a fish. It's a big fish trap. It's like 3 feet diameter and 8 feet long. And so they're doing a study on the.
One of those hoop nets?
Hoop net.
Yeah.
And so the fish go in and get trapped, and then the turtles go in after them to eat the fish. And there was one turtle she lost track of while she was getting it out of the net, and it clomped onto her knee.
How big was it?
Oh, there he is. Did it let go?
No, it kept trying to get a better bite, and finally she bent her knee enough, and then was able, and while it was trying to get a better bite, she kicked it off with her other knee.
Okay.
And this was, of course, she had on hip waders and pants. It didn't tear the pants, but the hip waders are all torn up.
Did it break the skin?
Yeah, she had lacerations and went for antibiotics and stuff.
They say that a snapping turtle won't let go unless it thunders, and I don't know if that's true, but they will not let go.
Yeah. Well, I don't think they can't hear, so that doesn't make a lot of sense.
I want to. I'm glad she's okay. Let's move on. Okay. We have Mr. Malconian. Welcome. How's your job? Okay.
Sorry you have sit through all this.
Well, sorry I made a violation, so I guess I'm getting...
So just to recap for commission members who did not know, I think the administrator arrived at the property, and there were four trees being cut, and his understanding was they were probably within the 100-foot buffer of the bordering vegetated wetland. There was a communication difficulty, I'll put it at that, between the administrator and the tree, Mr. Pacey of Royal Green Tree Service. And it got a little heated, and with a little bit of official police presence, there was finally productive communication. So there are two enforcement orders before us. One for the contractor and one for the resident. And the contractor, do you happen to know why the contractor, I'm just curious, do you happen to know whether the contractor was planning to appear and just couldn't make it, or
I don't know.
You don't know? Okay. Obviously the tree contractor
is. I have my own opinion on that second violation, but I'm going to keep my mouth shut.
It's an open public hearing. You're free to.
I think this man is doing a wonderful job. Who's not here tonight?
Yeah,
and
he
I've
is on
learned
vacation.
A lot tonight. I've learned a lot tonight. But I removed four trees from my backyard. It's written on this violation: four trees within 100 feet. It's only two really, and I have a plot plan here, and I can show you. I made copies.
That's great. We'd love to see
okay.
it.
Okay. And I showed you last night when you came up. Not last night.
I'm not sure I had a copy of it, but I
heard
you say that.
This is an original plot plan that was done by Hayes. The pool was added. I added a pool back in 1991, and it was approved by the Conservation Commission. I only have four copies.
Oh, great. Thank you.
And I have a copy for myself.
Okay.
And the bottom line is I thought I could remove a tree on my property. I did not know. This is the original pool thing, anyhow, so just
yeah,
so you know, it's
yeah.
a copy of that. And if, may I approach just to show you?
Yes, absolutely.
The two trees that are definitely in violation, if you look at it, I've highlighted, are two ash trees. The cherry tree is actually 103 feet away, and the pine tree is 118.
No, are these, those measurements are off this map? According to the, so was it a measurement?
I did the measurements off the shed, off the house, and off the pool.
But what I'm saying is this 103, you
yes.
determined that from
my lot lines.
Your, but this plan?
Yes, from this plan.
By using like a scaled ruler and
yes.
that sort of stuff.
Yes.
And okay, I just wanted to
and
get
I just
a sense of that.
Confusion too, because it shows my property line and it also shows a sewer easement.
Mm-hmm.
But the fence actually runs from this corner, includes this tree in the yard, does not include this tree. This tree
yes.
is actually the second
right.
ash
yes.
tree.
Is
actually the closest one, I think. No, it isn't. It's not the closest one. Out of the two trees, the one that's inside my fence is closest to the Isle Wetlands. But it's right inside the fence.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I did not know.
Did you install that fence?
The fence was installed with the pool.
And it was the fence was put there just because the why? Because the plants were on
the
other side.
The pool has
a pool by law protective.
Right, but I'm wondering why he put it where he put it when you had the fence, that chain link fence.
Because further beyond the fence was a stone wall, and there's a black there was a black silt I think they call it a siltation fence or when Johnson built the house.
Oh,
so
leftover silt fence?
It was leftover
from construction.
No, Don Johnson. And actually, Mr. Biller, who was on the Conservation Commission, made me aware that my house was never released from the original conditions from Johnson.
Oh.
You know, no one picked that up when I bought the house. So shame on maybe my attorney.
They
should have picked
that
up.
But when I put the pool in, he made sure that I was aware of it, so we got the pool approved by you people, but we also had the house, I guess, registered with the Registry of Deeds.
Yeah.
So
right.
if I do go
yeah.
to sell it, it should be
okay.
Yeah.
Certificate of compliance.
These ash trees, for the last 4 to 5 years, have been an issue. Okay, and I showed the fence that did get struck by a limb. One of my chain link fence is now bent in towards the woods. The branch has been falling off, and I did some research. Kind of in a scramble because we had the notice it said you needed a site plan. So, and I started doing some research, and I can't say it's like an emerald borer, but I think it's more like Dutch elm. But it's been over the course of the last 4 or 5 years, these branches have been coming on, off, and the tree. The first year I noticed is the tree was defoliated in the first of August, and usually it would go in October or the end of September. The leaves would fall off. And then the branches started going from the bottom up. If you come down and look at the other ash trees out there, this side in the same way. So these trees were both within striking distance of I think his opinion is different than mine, but an ash tree grows anywhere from 55 to 90 feet on average. And you can see the trees that are out there right now. I feel I'm fully responsible for this. I broke the rules. What I tried to explain to Chuck, I think his name was, and you have to kind of draw a mental picture in your head. This tree man was working at my yard. He just buried his tree climber off the cellar from Reading the Friday before he did my job. Mm. The fatal accident in Boxford from a tree.
Oh.
Mm. He's hanging 40 feet on a tree. He's got a crane taking tree trunk sections, 3,000 pounds, over my house. Two trees that really should be in question were already done. And I think he wanted him to stop in midstream and climb down another tree. And that kind of got him upset.
Oh, yeah.
And it was 95 degrees. And you got to think what's going on over in this tree guy's head. He's never going to let anybody climb a tree again but himself. He's still going around thinking about what happened last week. And I told him, I said, you know, it might be a good idea just to take his name, it's all over the side of the truck, his sign's up front. Call him, send him a certified letter.
Mm-hmm.
Don't talk to him. Go to call him tomorrow. Just not the difference. And I was just trying to get a common sense approach.
Yeah.
Did not happen. So the tree guy did come down, and I think he basically told him, when my crane is put away, all my equipment is safe, I'll talk to him. He didn't like that, and call him. When the Reading police did come, I went up to see what was going on. Talking to the administrator. He basically told the administrator that those trees needed to come down. He's a certified arborist. He's been doing this for 25 years. And he even admitted that he was more qualified to make a decision on a tree than he was. And he also stated that if I did come to you people with his opinion, he would have given me permission.
Mm-hmm.
This is all my fault, not this poor guy's fault. And I just can't stress how upset it is that he brought up a violation on him. And I think, I don't know how to put it, spiteful?
Yeah.
Against the tree guy. And I resent that myself. And I was helping them to a citizen. I am guilty. Okay. I did violate two trees. I did not know. Ignorance. But he had to be there for the situation to understand the outcome. It was just a very bad situation at a very bad time. It's my responsibility.
That said, it looks like there are two that are outside of the 100 feet.
Yeah, but there's two well within.
Just barely.
Yeah.
We did go for a site visit on Monday. There are two that are a lot closer to the wetlands, and I would say
if I'm going to
use this. Anybody have a ruler?
Yeah.
Thanks.
One is probably within 10 to 15 feet. Scale, I think it's 20 feet.
Yeah, so that's 10 feet for the ash tree to the left and, you know, closest.
15 to 20 feet.
Yeah. And these, you know, looking at the stumps, there was not obvious rot in the stump itself.
And you know, with Dutch elm disease,
is there any treatment for Dutch elm disease? Is there, what I'm asking, is there another option besides cutting?
Cut the tree down.
That's it?
It could be also what they call a green borer, but that has not made it out of this part of the state. I know it's in southern New Hampshire. I just, after this all happened, I started really going, oh my God,
yeah.
I got talking to people.
I hope it's not here.
Right. But there are other trees out there, don't they? The pine tree was a whole different. There were branches falling on my shed on that one, in the cherry tree.
Yeah,
every time it snowed, the pine tree was leaning. It went the weight of snow. The last three, and my daughter slept in the bedroom upstairs, and she has this huge skylight, and I was panicked every time we had snow because I was convinced it was just going to come right down onto her bedroom.
But the bottom line is I feel this is all my responsibility. I mean, you know, and then the question is, geez, he should have known there were wetlands there. Do you really think my dad looks like this? Well, let's see how thick that forest is. I mean, he was originally coming to my neighbors across the street because they had some dead trees. and they were aware that they had to come to you people, or at least call them. I went over there today before I came here, and it's obvious their backyard's wetlands.
Yeah.
There's nothing to their backyard. Mine's a whole different story if you see what I'm talking about. I know there's wetlands out there. I lived on Forest Street, and I know all about wetlands as far as, I've never had water myself in both houses, so when you're talking about wetlands, I'm telling you, it works for me, you know, on that. But as far as trees, I did not know, honestly, I need permission to take them down on my property. And now I do.
It is,
I apologize.
As Anika said, we did make a site visit, and those two trees are cut down. There was no other damage around the trees. He didn't bring in heavy equipment and trim down the brushes or anything like that. The trees were gone, that was that. And I think that if we put in a couple small trees or shrubs around where those two stumps are, a couple around each, the net loss to the resource area would be zero or maybe possible.
When you say shrubs, could it be like fruit bushes or anything like that, like blueberries? Or
sure.
Have to be?
We'd prefer native plants. That are wetland friendly. Chuck does have a list of those.
Okay,
yep. Part of the enforcement order mentioned something about do you have the arborist's original recommendations concerning the removal of the trees?
No, it was called three trees companies to come in, and they all gave me prices.
And it was verbal.
And none of the tree companies mentioned anything to us about that this might be a violation. It was three different, we just took the best price.
Right.
One was out of Clean Sweep Out of Woman.
All right.
He gave me the best price and was going to release my damage to my lawn.
Right.
Because he brought a crane in and he did brown out the grass where it is, but water's going to fix it.
Right.
So.
Right. And as I think I discussed this with you at the site visit, you know, in way of understanding where we're coming from, we have gotten many, many, many instances this year alone, I believe, where trees have just been cut with no prior notice and no prior warning and, you know, no understanding as to whether the people understand there are wetlands there or not. I've actually been on my way driving somewhere, and I do happen to know that wetlands are in a certain place. And I've stopped at one or two houses because I've seen huge cranes moving enormous trees out of people's backyards. So, you know, unfortunately, the practice for us is we don't have enough residents aware of their wetland area and aware of the permissions needed. And I think, unfortunately, the education happens when there's a violation, and that's not our preferred method of doing this.
But I thought I was pretty well aware of the wetlands, honestly, being in about two different homes.
Hmm.
Okay? I mean, I knew.
What was your understanding
I've seen people bring, all of a sudden their backyard gets bigger. I knew you weren't supposed to fill.
Yeah.
I knew you weren't supposed to dump out there.
Yeah.
But I had no idea, really, trees gonna hit my house. Do I really have to ask permission? I guess I do. But I mean, I honestly thought.
Anika, there's, as you said, there have been many, particularly recently, tree cuttings in and adjacent to wetlands. Half a dozen in the last year or so.
And I'm one of them.
In none of those cases did we ever cite the tree company. There's really
there was discussion about this at the last hearing.
Yeah.
Oh, for which Galvin?
Yeah.
James Rowe. Well,
oh,
maybe Galvin,
James?
Certainly. Also, but James. I think long ago they have been cited. I think Chuck was at a seminar where the subject came up, and it was felt that you need to let the contractors know.
It just seemed like
about
it was madder at the tree than he was me, and I thought I should
know
if it's going to go off.
No,
you're a nice diplomatic gentleman.
Well, I deal with public all day long, and I know
these guys picking up
enforcement order on a tree cutter? I mean, would we require him to pay for part of these plantings?
No, I think one thing that.
Well, they issue a fine at worst, but contribute to the restoration of the plantings.
I'd always agree, because fine goes to the town, the restoration goes to the resource area.
Right, that's what we usually do, we don't issue fines.
There's that, there's also, you know, we could require that contractors, sort of as a policy moving forward, that contractors who violate this have to take a course in where the wetlands are in town and how to kind of clue into that and understand the 100-foot buffer zone.
We couldn't require that from this commission, that have come from.
I just thought if you asked 100 people, maybe 5 or 10 would know.
Not before he's licensed to practice, but before.
Well, I think that's what he's trying to get at.
If a contractor is cited to be in violation of cutting down trees within the buffer zone without getting a permit ahead of time.
I mean, I suggested the other night.
I mean, that's going to.
Tree removal town of Reading, must be 15, 20 contractors come up.
Right.
Send out a notice to them.
Yeah.
Right.
There it is, be notified that in Reading, you know.
So sometimes, I appreciate that. Letters, sometimes we get no response from letters.
I think Chuck
violations, sometimes there's.
Chuck thinks a professional does this every day. They frequently remove trees near wetlands. They should know better. And I think, you know, at Galvin Circle, they made the owner sign a release. The owner said, nope, the town said it was okay. And they made him sign a release, actually sign a paper saying that there are no wetlands here because he knew better.
The tree company made the owner sign a release.
So some of them do know, and I think Chuck, his feeling is, and this is what he said. His feeling is the reason why his anger was directed at this individual is probably because he feels that they do it every day and they know that this is what happens.
It's just, this was a tough situation for this guy.
Right.
And
I understand.
He's got
now.
This guy's head was already.
Yeah. But Chuck
certainly.
Walking into that couldn't have known that.
Certainly.
He did, as he told.
Yeah.
So,
he said, just please come and talk to me. This is my home.
I did. I really did. And then on the tree guy's side, he's a certified arborist.
Right.
And if he states those trees have to come down, there's no way the town of Reading is going to accept liability. Hitting my house and saying, no, I can't take it down. So I think that was going through his head at the same time. And he tried to explain that to me. He also said, you know, you can't predict. But you look at these ash trees when this disease comes around, and this is common in these ash trees. And I did a lot of research today instead of being at work pretty much.
Well, his mouth is still very sore.
But
the ash tree is very susceptible to this Dutch elm disease. And I'm sorry. I don't know what else to say. I just feel bad for the tree.
We just, as residents, we've lived in Reading for 30 years. We are thrilled that we live next to wetlands because of what that affords us as residents. There's a lot of birds, there's deer.
Nobody ever has nightmares with these people.
Yeah, I mean, we have no.
Well, if you've got the right elevation difference from a wetland, it can be a very pleasant neighbor.
Well, we've always loved that about where we live. And I told my husband, feet first, pine box, that's how I'm leaving. I'm never moving. And, you know, of course, we just feel terrible that we did violate something, but we feel worse that the situation was exacerbated by a very angry conservation man with someone who wasn't about, you know, that we hired.
Yeah.
It was us.
There was extenuating circumstances with this guy. I mean,
and my husband did explain to Chuck the extenuating circumstances, and he didn't want to address that at all. That's when he called the police.
Yeah.
And he even had to leave my job to bring his headsets to OSHA and have them inspected and stuff like that. And they actually, you know, it was all involved. I mean, he's all set. He did nothing wrong. It was a fatal accident. That was just a fluke. You know, I mean,
it's dangerous work.
Right. It's the most dangerous job besides a fishing.
I think that if the conservation gentleman was as professional as our tree man in handling the communication, it wouldn't have been so difficult for all of us.
But his head wasn't in the right place.
Well,
it was like taking two. I could just see it. I said, oh my God, this is just the worst. storms a week, that's it.
I'd like to move ahead to the plan moving forward.
Yes.
So, at this point, moving forward, there's some talk about planting a couple of blueberry bushes and possibly one additional tree. What's the sense of the commission?
The stumps stay?
Oh, yes, leave the stumps.
They have to stay.
Not grind the stump.
No.
No, just leave them. They'll naturally degrade.
The other two that aren't within the 100 feet, can I do something with?
Yeah, you can grind it if you want, but.
Yeah, I mean, one of them was right up against your fence, so if you grind that up, I don't know if it would undermine the fence post at that, you know, so.
It's at their option, it's at their option.
It's up to you.
Yeah, it's up to you. You're outside of the 100 foot for those two.
When Johnson was developing the property, or they put some type of bad fill in, but there's an area outside my shed, that every year just keeps getting deeper and deeper.
Yeah, I got the same thing.
Those trees they cut, they just cut them.
Oh, yeah.
Could have been an old tree.
I'm trying to avoid that with the two trees that aren't within the buffer zone.
Yeah.
That's my only rationale there. But the other ones, I'd be happy to plant, plant around.
And you have a list of what would be plantings that are appropriate?
Chuck has a list.
Okay.
Yep, so I think the next thing we, well, do we want to see this on the plan?
Are you good going with Chuck, or would you rather avoid?
I don't have a problem. I just really feel what's going on with the tree guy. It's my opinion, but I'm not sitting where you are. I'm just, if you understood the situation, like I explained, giving explanations, so good enough. The guy's going through a lot right now, and his thought process is these trees would have come down anyway.
Because
I'm a certified arborist for 25 years. I mean, this guy's been around, Royal Green Tree Service. He's been around Stone and Wakefield for years. He's now out in New Hampshire because he moved. But he still does work down here, and I really don't think he thought there was wetlands over there. He never asked me. But not one guy asked me out of the three that price my.
Yeah, well, that's
what we're hoping to avoid.
The issue we need to address is how to educate.
And I'm not saying he's a bad guy. I'm just saying it was just the perfect storm.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's go ahead and close that the enforcement order against the resident, and then we can talk about the one against the with the arborist.
Okay.
So, I would suggest that if you get together with Chuck, come up with names of a tree or two and two or three bushes, and just mark on the same plan where you're going to plant them.
Will he tell me where to put them?
He might give you some advice, but it really should
in the
be
vicinity.
More what's convenient and
what works
compatible
your
with
yeah.
your yard.
Yeah, yeah, right.
But it should
but
be in the vicinity
in
of
the
what
vicinity
was
would be
what
good.
Was removed.
And then bring that plan back to us. We can vote on it. It's approved, and that's the end of the enforcement.
Okay, so I come to another hearing, or do I just see him?
We'll see him, and then.
I don't think he has to. I mean,
you don't have to
yeah,
come. Just
the plan is self-explanatory.
If you
got this plan, you can come if you want. It's a lot of fun here. You can see
you and
it's
Chuck.
It'll be a half hour, 45 minutes.
Yeah,
right,
well.
Right.
Well, yeah.
So okay.
That's like the registry.
Right. So, three shrubs, two trees.
That's not good with that.
Any idea what type of trees? Maples. I mean, I don't know.
Well,
you can get. He has lists of native. Wetland,
okay.
Friendly trees
and
shrubs.
Be in that general vicinity, also,
yes.
Right?
Within, you know, within 10 feet,
okay.
I would say, or
yeah,
10 or 15 feet.
Yeah, I mean, you don't
because otherwise you're going to interfere with the root zone.
Right, and you don't want to plant something that's going to grow up and
down.
Your grandchildren are going to have to worry about falling on the house again.
Right, I was
so
thinking more like putting the blueberry bushes on the inside of the fence.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
Right on the other side of the fence, maybe putting whatever, maple.
Red
maple
or
red
whatever.
Maple.
It sounds appropriate.
I like that.
Yeah. That sounds appropriate.
All right.
Some of those plants, you know, will thrive in
right.
that environment, so you won't even
oh,
have to do too
I
much.
You saw the ones on my little house of forest.
Yeah,
tree,
yeah. And I think there's a, I mean, from I really wanted blueberries in my yard, so, and it's not a wet yard. So I talked to somebody
It won't, it didn't. Oh, I think.
You're destroying them in 5 minutes.
That too, that too.
The birds get a hold, you gotta cover them.
But also, I think for blueberries, there's a little bit of a thought process to how those bushes need to be planted. Like, one is a early blooming, one's a mid-spring blooming, one's a late spring blooming. In order to get the appropriate cross-pollination, you need at least one of.
At least two.
At least two.
Yeah.
So that are, so you can't get an early and a late next to each other and expect to see blueberries that you need. You know, you need an early and a mid. So talk to.
So we just contact him next week? Is that what we do? We just.
We're going on vacation.
I know. We have a 6 a.m. flight for vacation in the morning, actually.
Oh, okay.
He'll be back next Wednesday. Does he work regular office hours?
He's afternoons. If you call, right, he also works in another town. So if you call his phone number,
which is on our stuff, yeah.
He has a message on that voice line that tells you his office hours.
All right, and let me see if there's any fine, just put it in writing now.
Did you want to discuss, I think, you know, my hope for every resident who lives near the wetlands is that they become stewards of that wetland. You know, and you learn that about our setbacks and come to see us before any work is done within 35 feet of those wetlands, within 100 feet of those wetlands.
I did mention my rotted fence last night.
Yeah.
Yep, you did mention the rotted fence. And
for the benefit of the other commissioners, he has a
stockade.
6 or 8 foot stockade.
6 foot.
And some of the panels are deteriorating. And under our new regulation, if he's going to use the existing post or even the existing post hole and replace that fence, he doesn't even need to come before us.
Right.
Because he's not doing any disturbing land, it's manicured lawn. It's
and most of the panels are outside 100 feet
away.
But there might be one panel where that juts in.
Down here.
Yeah, right in here, actually. No, I'm not touching that. Just going up here.
Up here.
Forest Street.
Well, when you get down here, come revisit us.
Yeah,
that's the chimney.
One of these
that's
panels is like 98 feet from there. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
But I'm going to use the existing post.
Yeah.
You can use
but
the
this
existing
is chain.
Post or even
that's
the
chain. Yeah,
that's
all
chain.
That's
yeah.
not
yeah.
being touched.
Yeah.
We're not touching that.
Yeah.
And the only thing I will be asking if I could is where the tree did bend it. I was going to ask
over
if
here.
They could straighten the pole back.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
I don't think that doesn't disturb the soil or the vegetation.
Pulling in points of concrete around.
I don't see.
It may involve pulling the pole straight and then putting some concrete around the existing concrete.
That sounds like possibly a minor purpose.
If you don't have to dig, you're probably okay. But if you have to dig the soil to put in the concrete, then it's probably a minor part.
But
okay.
Well, that's still a minor.
The fence guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If he can just bend it back and pull the concrete in where it's straightened up without digging, then you're good. But if he's got to dig, we probably should have a higher
permit. Okay.
It's always good to let the fence guys know about this, because quite often they'll put a fence right through a wetland without asking anybody to.
Yeah.
All right, well, I appreciate it.
All right, well, thanks for coming.
Yeah.
Thank you for your time and patience.
Have a good vacation.
Yeah,
thank you.
There's nothing good on TV anyway.
Yeah.
Socks are probably losing.
Football season's almost here.
That's what I think.
I'm excited.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
I think we should table this so we want to check this
out. Yeah.
Well,
we need to hear what his reasoning is.
I think that's true, but I think we could have some discussion before Chuck gets back, because we don't want to inflame the situation.
Well, we did discuss it a little bit.
Yeah, I
you did
not, not tonight. I'm saying
reasons.
prior to
what,
tonight.
What did you guys conclude?
Well, we really didn't conclude anything. We recognize that there's an issue with the recent
tree cuttings.
The recent tree cuttings.
This was at the previous meeting you're talking about.
Yeah.
We discussed.
Previous,
it.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that, you know, we need to explore what we're gonna do about that. And you know, like he said, that Chuck said, you know, unless you put the professionals on notice, or at least notify them one or the other, you know, it doesn't have to be through enforcement order, then, you know, the homeowners, how are they going to know?
Well, I think
Definitely.
We should work on a policy to notify them. Absolutely. I think that's a good idea. What I'm concerned about is that in this inflamed situation, if this is the first time we impose a fine or a penalty on an arborist after half a dozen have gone unpenalized, it would not, it would appear to be biased and vindictive.
Yeah, I think the policy should be to send all arborists, and certainly ones that create violations, a schedule of the MACC trainings that goes on, or any other wetlands trainings that we know of. Like I said, I don't think we can force them to go to take these courses, but they should know that they exist, and they should know that it's an issue.
And they should always come by Town Hall and ask Chuck.
Right. But this certainly does time happen. The same companies continue to commit violations. They don't learn. They're not changing their behavior. And
who was the company on 37 James? I don't really know. I don't know who it was.
I don't know who that was.
I'd forgotten about him signing that waiver at Galvin, but now that you mention it, I remember that.
Yep, he had signed a waiver.
See, so that company knew.
He knew.
He knew.
In Northeast Tree knows. When I went to talk to the guy on Willow Street from Northeast Tree, he was right there. He said, no, we're back over here. We just did parking.
Yeah.
No, he absolutely knew.
Yeah. I think, you know, getting the message out, you know, what's the most effective way?
Yeah.
Sending letters out, I'm not sure people would, I'm not sure tree companies would take it seriously.
You can send it certified return receipt, and you can say that they were notified. I mean, that's
well, that might be a better way to send a notice, you know, because then maybe the
and you
tree
can say, you know, we've had several violations in the last 6 months.
There's
you need to be aware that if there's any doubt, you will be held responsible. Blah blah blah. So they'll be put on notice.
And let them know 100 foot from a resource area.
How did we come up with that list of arborists? 30-mile radius.
You could, but that's a huge list.
There's a handful of guys who do work. Certainly people who are in Reading, North Reading, Moore and Stoneham, you know, businesses that are based in those areas would be.
Is there any registration for arborists?
I'm sure.
I'm sure that
certified
there's
arborists, yeah.
There is.
Business organization.
So.
Well, if we could access that list.
I'm sure it's
just
publicly
do
accessible.
A,
I know the engineering list is.
Just pick. A dozen or so zip codes around us.
Where the state certified arborist is?
I think a lot of this is just created by Chuck's frustration of not being able to get everything done that he wants to get done. And, you know.
Well, I don't want to.
I think you overreacted probably. But,
well, Chuck called me that afternoon, and this was before the police arrived. You know, and what I was hearing was, I got somebody cutting trees, and he refuses to talk to me. He refuses to even take 5 minutes to talk to me. And he's really mad at me, and I can't even get him to talk to me right now. So this is somebody who...
Did he call you from the site?
Yeah, he did. And he said, and I've called the, you know... I've called the police and I'm going to issue an enforcement order. I said, go for it. You know, I mean, so, you know, when you've got somebody who refuses to talk to you and you know, and to sort of speak to that, you know, they were in the enforcement order, Royal Green Tree Service was called to attend this meeting tonight. To discuss this matter, and he's absent.
Well,
you know, so the enforcement order directly requires him to be at this meeting, and he's not here. So that tells me, you know, another level of non-engagement. You know, this is how, you know, what we have to say is going to be responded to. You know, how do you engage somebody who refuses to talk to you about a violation?
what choices do you have? You kind of don't have a choice but to take it up another notch.
If this fellow was operating a crane.
Well, I wasn't there.
He's not gonna talk to anybody.
No.
I wasn't.
He's gonna finish a job, his time is money.
I don't know, this is the full.
Well, not only that, if he has a truck hanging there.
Well, I don't know, I wasn't there, Chuck didn't say that, you know, I don't know what the full picture was, and I'd love to hear what Chuck has to say about this, because I don't see Chuck as somebody who, you know, vindictively flies off the handle, you know, and I think in this situation, there was a certain amount of perceived belligerence that he said, what else can I do right now? And so he called the police, and I said, what did you say to the police? He said that this person is in violation of the Wetlands Protection Act, and I need to talk to him. And when the police came, he said to the man, I believe this gentleman would like to talk to you, and please give me your license and registration.
See, Chuck's an agent of the town, and people can't be doing work in the town when an agent of the town is asking to speak to them because of what they're doing, and have that person ignore them. You know, and none of us were there, I understand, but I would think that if he called the police, then there was some pretty non-engagement. Like,
and
he did call Anika, too, as well, so.
And you know, and maybe this particular contractor did have a huge amount of additional things going on, but that was not communicated. Well, although, you know,
the resident said
it was communicated to Chuck, but is that cause to ignore a town's an agent of the town?
Yeah.
You know, sometimes, you know, we have to be adults and put the junk in one part of our brain so we can deal with our business. You know, so, you know, I think the issue of violations for tree cuttings we need to move on a policy for that, and something that everybody on the commission agrees with, and something that we all think is a fair attempt without giving Chuck a lot of additional clerical responsibility. You know, I don't want to weigh down Chuck's time with researching a ton of contractors. Maybe that, you know, I'd much rather have him work on the enforcement orders and review the permits.
And write orders of conditions.
So, you know, I think
who then will develop the policy?
Well, it could go to one of the commission members if somebody wants to step forward and give it a stab. I think especially with Chuck's limited time, I don't see how some of these additional projects are going to get done. He doesn't have. He has other priorities.
He has to do the statutory required things
like.
We could have a draft letter that one of the administrative agents, you know, Ann Gentile could send out. She could generate an address, so she could find out, get the addresses of arborists, send out a letter.
Well, let's.
We could ask her to see if there is a state licensing procedure for arborists. If there is, see if it's sorted by, or she can get it sorted by zip codes.
Okay. Well.
And
we get a draft letter. I mean, Chuck's probably got a letter in his head. I don't know if he needs to do it or what.
Okay. Well, then why don't I call Ann?
Yeah.
It's really, you know, the letter's really really basic, short, to the point, one paragraph.
Oh, yeah, it's one paragraph.
Four or five sentences. It's just, you know, this is what it is. This is our jurisdiction.
Well, I think once we have a draft.
I'm not sure how the office policy.
Oh, yeah.
As chair, I can't ask her to do it.
I'm pretty sure you cannot.
You better check on that.
I'll check. I'll check with Jean. I'll give her a call tomorrow, especially in Chuck's absence.
Right.
It might be my place to do that.
Right. In Chuck's absence. Right.
So maybe I can do that this week.
Yeah.
And if I can. Jean first, because she's in charge of a lot of the management personnel there, so. Okay.
All right.
So let's continue this on the agenda. It's an agenda item. Keep chipping away at it. So I want to welcome our last remaining public member. We have.
She's not going to do a commission.
She's all done now.
We should have picked a line, guys.
We have.
Second
we
thoughts.
We have Ms. Allison Steger here. And I think you all were given a copy of her resume and cover letter. I met with.
That was
thank you.
The package?
Mm-hmm. I met with her today.
Oh, here it is. I
she came over and watched my kids run amok. And thank you for taking time with me today. I really appreciate it. So I'll just invite her to, you know, introduce yourself and give a couple highlights from what you've provided us. And
well, basically, I just graduated in May from University of New Hampshire with a degree, or a Bachelor's of Science degree in Environmental Conservation and Sustainability. And a lot of my first work focused on field work. That's why it's not an environmental science degree. But so I took a bunch of wetland classes and wetland policy, like environmental policy, environmental law class. And I worked with Hancock Associates last summer. They're based out of Danvers. They're an environmental consulting and engineering company. And basically what happened all tonight, I would help my boss with as his intern, because he's having and I worked with like site plans, researching properties, going out delineating wetlands with him. I did a little bit in the winter with him too, so I've not a ton of experience with that, but a little bit. And I'm not currently employed, but I figured this was something that I could do while I'm looking for that, because I am very invested. I've lived here all my life, I love it here, so I figured, because there's an opening.
So you're living at your parents' home now?
Yeah.
And do you have plans to move out of Reading?
Not anytime soon. I'm trying to save money. My friends have all moved into Boston, but I'm trying to save.
They'll be coming back to Reading.
Yeah, exactly. They're going to come back eventually.
Because everybody's
worried.
Coming from Boston to buy houses in Reading and bidding
yeah.
up the market. So.
Exactly. Yeah. So, I'm planning on staying for at least another few years.
Great.
More. So.
Great.
Yeah.
This is exciting.
Yeah, it's good to see you here. Allie's a classmate of my daughter Margaret, and we were on the
science
team together at Coolidge. So I know she's very capable, so I'm really pleased to see you here.
Yeah, I went to the clerk's office and I filled out the application, but I just wanted to check it with you just at the bottom if that was like enough for the selectmen before I headed it tomorrow.
Oh, okay. Yep, so I advised Allison that the next steps are she goes before the Board of Selectmen.
Actually, they have a subcommittee in the selectmen now. You don't go before the full board.
Okay.
Okay,
so maybe they told you that.
She just told me to bring it back to her.
Yeah.
And they would, like, let me know.
Yeah, so it's like a volunteer subcommittee appointment.
They make a recommendation to the selectmen.
Oh, okay. Okay.
A heads up though to Bob, so
yep.
that this moves through quickly
yep.
would be great.
Yeah, I will do that. I will do that.
I'd like to move that we endorse Allison as and her credentials as a welcome and needed addition to the Conservation Commission.
Oh, I'll second that. All those in favor.
Please
all
tell
right.
Bob we
recommend you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm excited about your experience that you bring. And
she did say environmental law.
And, you know, I think there's a whole lot of what you've done and what you're interested in that is a really good fit for where conservation is at, especially lately. I take it you, I don't know, I think you've gone to other hearings. You said you went to one in Revere.
I went to one in Revere, and It wasn't as formal as this, it was just the Conservation Commission met
Yep.
with the engineering company and
Yep.
I was in the room with them, like,
Yeah.
listening and thing.
Yeah.
But yeah. And I do have some experience with dealing with the public because I worked at as a bank teller for like 3 or 4 years at North Shore Bank, so I understand like when people are get aggressive and things are not aggressive, but they can
You can say that.
Yeah. So I kind of have had some experience with dealing with that.
We have never had physical violence at a meeting. Now on site visits, this is a different story, but we've never
my
had any.
My old boss said he had a shotgun pulled on him a couple times.
Really?
Yeah, like, because he was like, what are you doing on my property?
Oh, boy.
Oh yeah.
Like
oh,
the
yeah.
person hired him to like do it. So
oh,
like,
yeah, I don't doubt
yeah.
that.
So, they told me all the horror stories.
Your experience with GIS will be useful too. My wife works for the town.
She's the GIS.
GIS
oh, really?
Coordinator.
I saw my huge book.
Yeah, so it's really valuable knowledge, and we use it a lot. Chuck uses it a lot. And we also need to know its limitations.
Good point.
So,
I mean, you've done wetland delineations, haven't you?
Yeah, I've done it. I mean, I've never done any on my own, but I've done them with him, and he let me do one, but he was like checking with me.
So
and
you
I took a lot of I took a soils course, and then we did a lot with soils in my wetlands classes, so I know like hydric soils and things
mm-hmm.
like that.
And you understand the difference between the line you mark on the ground and what you look on an overlay map.
Oh yeah.
Did you have Sid Pilgrim?
No, I didn't take his wetland delineate. I was going to, but then my internship interfered with his class, but I've heard he was awesome. So
yeah,
I
yeah,
might,
he's a legend.
I honestly might take it next year.
Yeah, he's definitely.
Because I've heard it was worthwhile.
Yeah.
Yeah. So awesome. After going through the review committee, then they make a recommendation to the selectmen, and then it's the selectmen who appoint, right? And
yes.
then after that, you're not officially a member until you're sworn in with the town clerk.
Which you can just go up to the window and they swear you in. So
yep.
you sign the book
yeah.
and yeah.
Yeah. And I think the town is due for some ethics training. I think
we have to go through ethics training.
Did we just do that?
Come on.
Good 3 years.
It's been a while.
I sat in this room like.
It's been a while.
Has it been 2 years?
I did it over at the police station maybe 3 years ago.
Hmm.
We did it here. Huge crowd.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right here in this room.
Yeah. Yeah. So.
I've taken it 3 times. I think you're supposed to take it every 2 years.
And then
my
first one was online.
Really?
I thought I took it online.
There
right?
was a refresher,
yeah.
wasn't there online,
I took
and you
it
had
online.
To it had to be done by December 31st.
Yeah,
anyway.
one year I took it online.
It's just understanding the rules of being on committee. There's a open meeting law you have to understand and things like that.
Conflict of interest.
Conflict of interest.
Oh, I do just have one question. When I'm looking for a job, is there any like if I do get on this committee, is there like any like things I can't do?
Yes, if you work for company XYZ and company XYZ is representing a applicant at this hearing, you have to recluse yourself.
Okay.
You don't
okay.
have to quit the commission, you just have to
for that
not
for that
participate
hearing.
Okay.
Yeah.
For
that hearing.
That makes sense. I just assumed.
It's actually happened to me. They were discussing a project that my company had worked on and I left the room. So
okay.
I think it's happened to all of us.
Or for instance, to be a neighbor applies. Same thing.
Yeah, okay.
And the reason when you recuse yourself, you leave the room is, you know, to really just remove any, you know, facial gestures
yeah.
or.
Well, that's still an open question. You don't
have
to.
No, they said
you
don't have to. Yeah,
you
can
sit
in the back of the room.
It is a public hearing and everyone is welcome to stay. And maybe, you know, people who recuse themselves can go and sit in the back of the
That's
room.
Right. You can even ask questions if
yeah,
you want.
Yeah, and ask questions.
Because you are
a
part
yeah.
of the public.
What type of job are you looking for?
I'm leaning more towards environmental consulting, but I'm pretty open to anything right now. I'm still trying to figure it all out to really pinpoint it.
Well, I've worked for environmental consulting firms for 40 years, and having this on your resume, being on this commission, will definitely
Well, that's what I was thinking, too. I was
yeah.
talking with my mom about it, and I was like, I should just go for it. I mean, I don't have as much experience as all of you, but I was like, I have
doesn't
my
matter.
Schoolwork. And
no, it doesn't
that.
Matter.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah, so I'm excited. So.
I mean, there's different backgrounds. I don't particularly know what Terry's background is, but he came on the commission new. He had trail.
He's a professional fisherman. Or he was at one point.
Well, there you go.
Commercial fisherman.
So you don't have to have an environmental, but so you're actually probably ahead of the game, right out of the gate. So yeah, you'll learn as you go, like a lot of us do.
Well, we've had teachers, lawyers, scientists, engineers.
Yeah.
We're partial to biologists, though.
I think it's really great that the commission would be made up of people with a lot of different backgrounds, and because everybody gets to bring, you know, their expertise to contribute to the review of these permits and the comments. And there's so many different facets of these permits that need to be addressed and looked at. So I think the more different the members are, the better. So
especially for your line of work, gives you real world practical experience with
yeah.
the public.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Which is, you know.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So thanks for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Yeah, we're glad
you're
here.
You're welcome to stay.
Do you have my book that I
left? Yeah, here.
Okay.
Yes, I do. Thank you for letting me borrow it.
Oh, my God. You're already borrowed books, right?
I am. Why not? You're welcome to stay and listen to our old new business, but it's probably not going to go for much longer.
Yeah, actually, I have 8 or 10 guests coming in, so I would like to
should we approve the
minutes? Quickly as we
okay,
can.
Yeah, let's do that. I know you're busy.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks for coming in. And you have my contact information. Go ahead and get in touch with me for when you go to the volunteer board and when you're at the Board of Selectmen.
It's going
to
take
okay.
a couple
I'll,
of weeks at least.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I'll count on you
probably
to kind of let me
know.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect.
So that I can put it on my calendar.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, thanks.
Okay, 22 Pond View Lane Shed, the minor project. You want to pull that out and we can just sort of take a quick look at it.
Minor project. 22 Pond View Lane. Let me see here.
What do I have on my notes from Chuck? I don't have anything on this.
Minor project in... Oh, wait. Oh, install an 8x10 shed.
Okay, so the shed looks to be, well, it's well out of the 35. It's got to be, well, that's the 100 foot. That's 100
is
foot.
Is there
so
a foundation?
Between,
I'm pretty sure 8x10.
It's above a retaining wall on an existing lawn between 50 and 100 feet.
But I'm pretty sure 8x10 by the town standards does not require a permanent foundation, so it can go on cinder blocks, which makes it, they just bring it in and they set it and it's done. So.
Okay, I don't know the size of the shed. Is that
8x10,
what,
it says. Yeah, it says 8x10.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a conservation restriction back here.
Yeah.
Yeah, Bonview Vale, I think, right there. If I remember correctly.
Yeah, I remember the name.
I know mine's 8x12 and it doesn't require a full foundation, so this is below that.
This to me looks like a good minor project.
It is.
Okay. So.
We don't have to approve this. So.
No. Any objections to this minor project?
No.
Hearing none?
Sounds good.
Let's go forward on that. No objections to that. Administrator's report. I don't know if there's. I don't think there's anything.
No, that's the end of the file here. So. Let's see here. That's it. It's here.
I do have one thing. We are at the rotation point in our terms, and we designate that as rotating officers. So I would like to have on the agenda for our next meeting election of chair and vice chair.
I don't have any objection to that. Any comments or questions or discussion? No.
Yeah,
so we'll make that an agenda item.
Okay, I'm probably not going to be available for chair.
Okay.
I just don't have the time.
Preemptive comment.
Could you remain as
I probably
vice?
I could definitely, but you know,
okay.
the time commitment that's required is really difficult for me with my workload.
Okay.
So. I'm just putting that out there now so people can, we can start thinking about what, how that's gonna work.
That's fine.
You know, cause, you know, I know that last year I had said that that was gonna be my likely path, but I think that, you know, I have a hard time making, obviously, site visits and meetings sometimes, so.
Yeah, and I understand that.
I think it's good that the chair has been able to meet with Chuck. That's a problem I would have since I work in Gloucester, being here.
Yeah, and Chuck, yeah. And Chuck actually meets, I usually meet with him either Monday or Tuesday before the Wednesday meeting, and, you know, he shows up at my house and I put on a movie for my kids.
That's cool.
You mean, well, especially because it's summertime now,
cool.
You know, or, you know, when it was school time, it was actually quiet in the house, but.
He is here late.
Tuesday.
Tuesday.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Till 7?
Yeah.
That's not late for me. Not late enough,
yeah.
But. So yeah, let's talk about this further at the next meeting then.
Yeah.
Something that Chuck did mention to me the last time I did talk to him regarding, I have to go back to the notice of intent for 26 Harrison Street, and that was the one that the original notice of intent was filed back in 2002. He's thinking if they refile a notice of intent, that we need to close out the old order of conditions before.
It just expires on its own, I believe. I don't think there's any action we have to take.
That we need to issue a certificate of compliance for that.
No, we don't. It's not in compliance.
For what?
For the previous work that they didn't do.
No, because it's not in compliance. It just expires after 3 years, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've never heard of it.
Well, if we do need to do that, maybe we could do that before that other permit is resubmitted.
I don't.
It's not officially resubmitted right now.
Right.
And they didn't withdraw it either, did they? It just.
No, they didn't. It just expired and it never got recorded.
The certificate of compliance specifically says.
You can keep it open.
Oh.
So it's a public hearing.
That was all.
Sorry?
No.
We were kind of loud out here.
No, we were a lot louder.
Don't worry about it.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay.
The certificate of compliance specifically says on the certificate, you know, you must include a statement from the engineer that says that the work is in substantial
agreement
with the order of conditions.
Okay.
So
okay.
That's
okay.
That's not the case.
All right.
It's
I just wanted to.
Substantial disagreement.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, we've had a lot expire.
Yeah.
In that case, let's move to the minutes and
yes.
Take a look at that, because that's another item we have to. There's no bills?
There is no bills in the
there
folder.
No bills?
No.
So then I think one of the last items of business is the
and
minutes.
And there's no bills on the commission anymore.
No bills on the commission.
The will, but no bill.
The will, but no bill.
There's
a will.
The will, there's a way, but there's no bill.
Oh, boy, it's getting late.
There was something here, and I wish I had.
Okay, I was not at the last meeting, but I will bite my cheek and I will approve them if the other three members
okay.
are in agreement. Otherwise, I'm going to get up and leave.
Yeah, I reviewed them. I think I actually emailed Kim and said they were fine. So.
Yeah. So you want to move, we accept them?
Oh, yeah, so I'll move. Well, see, that's
minutes okay,
from
wait.
June 25th. 2014. I move to approve.
I second.
Okay. I just want a moment. I just want to make one correction to 29 Gavin Circle.
Yeah.
There's a sentence over a little bit over halfway through. It says it was suggested using granite bounds over boulders.
Yeah.
Can you just add one more sentence about that concrete poured posts were also acceptable.
Yep,
did they say that?
We
that
said that.
You said
that.
We
that?
Said
okay.
that. And because I don't want
poured.
Them based on these notes to
that
be
concrete
tied into granite
what?
Bounds. Concrete poured posts.
Poured concrete.
Board concrete.
Thank you.
Is any mine?
Your James Road.
Okay, I will.
Cause I got two of those.
I just wanted to make sure, especially for that one, cause we're gonna, our memory's gonna, you alright? Okay, so there's a motion and a second. All those in favor approving the minutes amended? All approved. Okay, any other business? Hearing none? Meeting adjourned. I'll make the motion.
Yeah.
And second.
Soon we can, I mean, I think anytime.